Hello and welcome to a belated episode of WGTC Radio, the official podcast of entertainment website We Got This Covered. I am Jonathan Lack.
And I am Sean Chapman.
And we are here to talk about a lot of stuff that we missed over the month of December. Very simple reasons we didn't have a podcast, but a myriad of them.
Yeah.
What was the first one, Sean? Just being busy with finals and stuff?
Yeah. Because the last podcast we did was right before finals week started, so obviously that is a very, very busy time for us. So
it's
difficult to find time to do a podcast anyways, and then we both somehow separately got incredibly ill around that time period as well.
Yeah, right during finals week, I got one of the worst sicknesses I've had in, like, my adult life. I had a really bad case of bronchitis and a flu, basically, and I was coughing almost constantly, and I could not go more than a sentence or so speaking without coughing. So obviously, recording a podcast was out of the question.
Yeah.
What was wrong with you, Sean?
Yeah, mine was, there was a cough. Like, it wasn't, like, the bad part wasn't the cough, it was just more like a, like, I was just, like, really tired constantly, you know? It was that kind of sickness where, like, if I walked around too much, I would just get really exhausted and kind of, like, dizzy. So I would not have been able to do a podcast in that condition either.
Yeah.
And then it was Christmas, so
obviously,
you know, we both spent time with our family, so not doing a podcast then.
Right, yeah, so there was a lot of stuff. So we missed a lot of stuff. There are some things, you know, we're just not going to cover, certain news things that may have happened or, you know, little things on the side. But the big stuff from December we were going to do episodes on were to review The Hobbit, The Desolation of Smaug, which we're big Tolkien, you know, Peter Jackson fans, so we got to talk about that movie. We needed to do a retrospective on the 11th Doctor, since his time was coming to an end, for Doctor Who, and we need to talk about the Doctor Who Christmas special, The Time of the Doctor. We're going to do all of that in this episode.
Yes.
And obviously those are all spoiler discussions.
Yes.
There will be time charts. If you go to We Got This Covered, the article where this podcast is posted, you can check the time chart. I'll try to put it in the show notes on iTunes. Sometimes those don't fit, so we'll see. But we're going to talk about The Hobbit in spoiler terms. We're going to talk about The Time of the Doctor in spoiler terms. And we'll mix in with that, The Time of the Doctor discussion, our talk about the 11th Doctor.
Yeah.
So all will be maybe a little more contracted than it would have been if these would have been separate episodes. But it should be good. And then the next episode we're going to do, which will probably be, you know, first week of 2014, will be our big 2013 retrospective. You can already read my top 10 and next best 20 lists for films for 2013.
Why don't you just call that a top 30 list?
I put them in two separate posts.
It's just that's top 30 movies.
You can read about my top 30 movies on We Got This Covered. They're in two separate articles. A lot of good movies this year, so go ahead and read that. That's another thing. I was going to be making a top 10 video, and I got sick. I'm like, I can't record narration for this.
Yeah.
So I tried. I'm like, maybe can I cut it together, like if I record one sentence at a time? No, I couldn't make it through a single sentence.
That would sound so choppy and terrible,
I know,
too.
Yeah. So
should have done it. That would have been amazing.
Right. So that does not exist, but I will obviously talk about that top 10 on the podcast next week. Sean will be talking about gaming and some other stuff. So anything else to talk about, Sean?
I think we should talk about The Hobbit.
Yeah.
I think we should talk about Doctor Who. I think we should just always talk about those two things, honestly.
Well, let's start with The Hobbit. The Desolation of Smaug came out earlier in December. Sean, the world knows what I think. My review's been out for a while. What did you think of The Hobbit?
I really, really liked it. And, you know, the people who've listened to the podcast before know that I also really liked The Hobbit and Unexpected Journey. Like, I liked that movie a lot more than most people did. Like, I'm not saying it's not better than most of the Lord of the Rings movies to me, but I still really, really enjoyed it. And so, yeah, I think I like this movie just about as much as that one. Like, this one's a lot more action-heavy and doesn't have quite the sort of the heavy character arcs that the first movie had, but that's still cool. Like, I have some problems with this movie, and I have some I really love stuff about this movie. Kind of the same with the first.
Yeah, I'm really positive on Desolation of Smaug. I liked it infinitely more than the first movie in some ways. I think I like it a lot more, in part because I think they're just adapting a lot more story, and the movie feels a lot more busy because of it, and I like that. I like where they take the characters. I think we're just into the meatier part of the story to me, and I like it. It did make, I will say, it made me like An Unexpected Journey more in retrospect, in some ways, just for how I feel like they laid down certain character things with the dwarves and Bilbo really started paying off in this movie.
Mm-hmm.
And you can really start seeing that. I only have one big problem with Desolation of Smaug, in terms of big problem, and that's I really don't like the ending.
Mm-hmm.
Like, really, it annoyed the fuck out of me the first time I saw it. And the second time, it still annoyed me, but because I knew it was coming, it only annoyed me, you know, so much. I don't like the ending. We'll talk about that more later. I feel because it's an abrupt cut, and we're spoiling it, so I'll just say,
yeah,
we're, you know, 11 seconds away from Smaug destroying Lake Town, and it feels like the entire movie is building to that, and then it doesn't happen, and that was weird to me. Just because, you know, and I know there's doing it over three movies, and when we view it all together, it won't be as much of a problem. But especially if you look at An Unexpected Journey, and especially the Lord of the Rings movies, how Peter Jackson was so focused on arcing those films. And An Unexpected Journey is less arced than the Lord of the Rings movies, because you have things that are being set up that obviously don't pay off, like in that movie, I should say. Like all the White Council stuff and whatnot. But the main stuff with the characters, there's a conclusion there. You feel like you've seen a full movie.
Yeah.
To me, Desolation of Smaug, the entire second half, you've got all the scenes with Bard, and you've got all the scenes in Lake Town, and all the kind of placements of the characters. And it just felt natural to me that we were going on to that last scene where Smaug destroys Lake Town, because it just, I mean, literally, when we got to that scene in the movie, I had no expectation it was about to cut off. It felt like we were still in the middle of the climax, and it was really jarring to me. And that's the worst thing about it to me, is that it just felt like kind of instinctually wrong that that's where we're cutting this part of the story off. And it also, I don't know how that's going to work as the beginning of a movie. That's a little weird to me. That the what feels like the climax of this part of the story will start the next part of the story. Little odd. Again, I, you know, can't put full judgment on that until we see what they have planned for the third movie. If Peter Jackson has something fucking crazy in mind for that scene, and it just couldn't have happened in this movie, okay, that's fine. But, you know, ending aside, and this review was really hard for me to write. Because I had to mention that ending thing, because to me it prevents me from viewing this as its own movie completely.
Yeah.
But I love everything in the movie other than that. I love every scene. I love just about everything in the movie. There's the same holdover problems from An Unexpected Journey. There's way too much CGI. There are too many cutaways to the orcs. Azog looks terrible. You know, that kind of stuff.
Yeah. Luckily, Azog's not so much in this movie. He's got a couple of scenes, but...
And the orc they kind of replaced him with looks way better.
Yeah, he looks a lot better.
Yeah, he looks fine. I have no complaints, in fact. So, you know, those are little things to me, though, overall. I think this movie has just tremendous acting from everyone involved. I think it's got Howard Shore at his absolute best on the music. I love this score. It is fantastic. It's just got some of the best action-adventure scenes I've ever seen in a movie. Peter Jackson took some of those great iconic moments from the book and did as well as anyone could do with them. And he expanded on them too. You know, the barrel sequence.
Yeah, the barrel sequence is fucking awesome in this movie.
Yeah, so I love every scene in this movie. I thought they kind of hit almost all of it out of the park. I have one other complaint about a character, but we'll get to that later. What are some of your other thoughts, Sean?
Okay, so let's get a little bit deeper into the movie. Because I want to talk about the characters. So, like, what is the character that you have a problem with? I'm kind of curious.
I hate their Bjorn.
Their Bjorn's pretty weak. Like, the whole Bjorn section wasn't very well done to me. It wasn't like it was terrible, because it's such a tiny part of the movie.
Right, and I guess that's why
I really like that section of the book.
Yeah, and I love Bjorn in the book, and this is honestly the first time in Peter Jackson's Middle-earth where I saw a Tolkien character depicted on screen, and I just had a visceral reaction of, that is not the character. And they've changed characters before. You know, Faramir in Lord of the Rings, the movies, is very different than Faramir in the books. But I still
For God's sakes, Aragorn is, completely different between the books and the movies.
But you can still look at those characters and feel like they're in the right spirit, you know?
Yeah.
Like, that's still recognizable on a certain level.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I can now read Lord of the Rings and see Viggo Mortensen in my head. I cannot do that with this Bjorn. And I don't think it's the actor's fault. It's just the depiction, the idea that the bear is, like, unintelligent.
Yeah. It felt really weird to throw that idea in, that it's, like, the bear is, like, crazy, and then the guy is, like, a normal, relatively guy, when that's not in the book. Like, why even add that element to the character if that character's not going to be involved in, like, this movie almost at all?
Right. You know? And he comes in the Battle of Five Armies, and I assume we'll see more of him there. Yeah, I guess maybe they'll
expand that out, because I don't recall that being hugely significant in the book.
He comes in and it's cool. But, I mean, the Bjorns, this is actually kind of interesting. You know, most of the time in the Hobbit movies so far, they've done the Tolkien scenes to full length or even expanded them.
Mm-hmm.
The Bjorn scene is really the first scene where they really just compressed it.
Yeah.
Because that's a big scene in the book. Almost none of it is here. I'm not necessarily complaining about that, because I
think it's not hugely significant. Like, nothing is that disastrous right. for cutting it out.
It's a really good scene in the book. Pace-wise, I don't think it would have worked on film, and I almost wish they would have just cut the character if this is what they were going to do.
Yeah, then maybe had like the scene in there for like the expanded version or something if you wanted to see it or something.
Sure. I just like, and even his human form where he's like, he talks in like half sentences.
Yeah, he looks really weird. Like, I don't like his physical design.
Like, Bjorn in the book, if you don't know, he's like Gandalf, but gruffer. He's very smart. He's very forceful. He and Gandalf have these sort of match of wits that are great to see. And, you know, he's a regular dude, but kind of grumpy.
Well, and he can turn into a bear.
And he can turn into a bear, right?
So he's not just a regular dude.
Oh, I mean regular dude in terms of personality when he's a guy. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that's I guess what I meant. And he doesn't... And they overplay, I think, the element of him hating dwarves because he has kind of an aversion to dwarves, but he has an aversion to everyone because he's a total introvert.
Yeah.
You know, and so I, like, you know, the character didn't work for me in this movie, but as you said, it's such a small part.
Yeah, that relatively it's like, whatever. Like, if you had never read the book, I don't think you'd make note of that character at all in, like, a discussion like this, really.
Yeah. But then we go into my actually probably favorite scene in the movie, which is Mirkwood. Peter Jackson, you know, if you don't know, he's a horror director by trade. That's how he got his start. And for the Mirkwood section, he pulls out all the stops. And I love it. I think the intro getting into the spider stuff with all the little horror tropes of them going around in circles and the canted angles and everything. And it looks really good in 48 frames because he's using so many camera pans around the forest. I love all that, but even more so, when you get into the spider stuff, I think the way they depict Bilbo wearing the ring, and you have this long, and it's all like one-shot POV of what it's like for Bilbo to wear the ring.
Yeah.
That's fascinating, the way they show the ring's effect on Bilbo, and I think Martin Freeman's performance in this section in particular, you know, when he's trying to get the ring back from the spider, and then when he realizes what he's done and he almost is sick, that whole section to me is perfect, and it's such a great... It honors Tolkien, and it expands upon it, and to me, that's maybe my favorite scene they've... That and, like, Riddles in the Dark and Smaug later in this movie are my favorite things from this Hobbit series so far. Just fantastic.
Yeah, I definitely agree. Like, I wish I had rewatched An Unexpected Journey, like, right before watching Desolation of Smaug, because, to me, like, like, watching this movie on its own, like, having the Mirkwood section at the very beginning feels weird in terms of pacing. I think by the time the spiders come in, it feels a little bit better, but, like, the whole section building up to the spiders, it feels like... Because that's literally, like, in the first, like, 10 minutes of the movie. Like, that feels very strange to me that you wouldn't normally... Because, obviously, this is a really strange situation with cutting the book into three movies anyway, so there's going to be pacing issues with, like... Because I have not really watched An Unexpected Journey since it was in the theaters, so...
Well, and I don't know if you saw this interview, but Peter Jackson confirmed where the split was originally going to be when it was two movies.
Hmm.
And it was the barrel sequence. That was the climax of An Unexpected Journey originally. Hmm. So all of this was going to be in movie one. So they... I mean, literally, you are watching the middle of what was intended to be the first movie. And I actually felt, after reading that interview and then going to see Desolation of Smaug... I like Mirkwood as the beginning of the movie, and I don't know what it is, and it may just be
like, I think it would work infinitely better for me if I had watched the movie, An Unexpected Journey, right before seeing this. And like I said, like, by the time it gets to the spiders, I think that enough time has passed then for that to feel a little more appropriate, but like, there's something about, like, this being, like, not that it's the third scene in the movie, but it's like, it's the third scene in the movie. It's like, it is fucking Mirkwood, you know?
Yeah, it's I can understand that, and I guess for me, what I felt was... Especially after reading that Jackson interview, and then, you know, I watched An Unexpected Journey about a month before seeing Desolation of Smaug. But I think, as awkward as the pace can be in An Unexpected Journey, I like the idea of that film ending with Gollum and climaxing.
Yeah, I think that's like really, because the movie, the one thing I really, really like about Unexpected Journey is that it's all built around Bilbo's character arc. I mean, not all of it, but like that's the core of the film, is very much Bilbo's character arc going from being like this, you know, do-nothing hobbit in his hole to being the hero he is by the time he has, you know, bested Gollum, you know.
And I like that, too. And I like, then, that Desolation of Smaug opens with us seeing the fallout of that character arc. So that's why I like Mirkwood at the beginning. Mm-hmm. But I can understand your point of view on that, too. So...
Yeah. I mean, I like this better. Like, I like having the ending to Unexpected Journey better than having this beginning be a little bit funky. Because, again, and this is completely irrelevant... when I start watching these movies the way I'm going to want to watch these movies, which is in quick succession with each other. So
yeah. But even then, you know, I think having arc within a single movie, even if you're going to marathon them, it does matter to me. And I think because it just having things in close proximity makes them more powerful. Mm-hmm. You know, I think having, you know, Gollum happen as a climax, because that movie, just the way it's paced, it feels
definitely
better.
Yeah.
So, in any case, so that's Mirkwood. And then we have the introduction of the elves, which I think is all done very fluidly. Mm-hmm. And I like that. But we meet a lot of new characters here, and returning characters who are in a new light. So we have Legolas, we have Thranduil when we get to the Elven Palace, and we have the film's new character, Tariel, played by Evangeline Lilly.
Yes.
I'm a big Tariel fan. I thought she was great, and I thought Evangeline Lilly did great
work with her. Like, I thought one of the weaker parts of the movie was, I think it focused too much on the elves to me. Like that was, like, one of the, where the pacing kind of, like, took a hit for me of, like, why are we spending so much time with the elves and developing the elves and, like, this, like, love, this, like, romance relationship between her and, is it Feely?
It's Keely.
Keely. Yeah, I get those two mixed up, understandably so.
Yeah. Well, and, yeah, I mean, and it's complex, and I think part of, there is a pacing problem in this movie. Yeah. It's the exact same thing that happens in An Unexpected Journey, where the first and third acts are Bilbo heavy, and the middle is Martin Freeman doesn't have a fucking line for an hour. And I guess I had just accepted going into Desolation of Smaug, they are not pitching him as the main character in these movies. And
yeah, I mean, they have very much an ensemble. Like, they have, like, three main characters, because they have Gandalf, they have Thorin, and they have Bilbo. Like, that's very much what it feels like to me.
Yeah, and I mean, it's even, you know, even in, I think, just one of the things, and I think this is because they shot it as two movies and expanded it, and there's no real way to fix it. But when you look at Lord of the Rings, that movie has obviously several leads to it. That trilogy has several leads.
Yeah.
And it has an ensemble focus, but whenever you cut back to Frodo, you feel centered. Those movies do a really good job to me of making feeling centered around Frodo's journey. Even if you go an hour without seeing Elijah Wood, when you come back to Frodo, that feels like the center.
Well, that's, and part of this is because, like, everything in, like, the plot of the Lord of the Rings is all focused on what Frodo is doing. Like, everything that Aragorn and Gimli and Legolas and Gandalf and Merry and Pippin are doing, all that stuff is to help Frodo.
Exactly. And I think, you know, you don't have that with The Hobbit. Yeah. And so expanding it to three movies and the way they've done it, it's, you know, whether it's a good or bad thing, I still want to reserve judgment on that until we see all three movies.
Yeah.
But Bilbo has been de-emphasized. And I guess I've accepted that, and I don't know if I agree with that as an interpretation or if I 100% like it. Again, I want to see all three before I judge that. But for me, I guess I like all the parts of this world enough that in the middle hour when we are focusing on the elves a lot, I was okay with that because I liked those characters and I thought that was good stuff. And it didn't really feel awkwardly paced to me, I guess. But it's all a matter of, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and for me, I think it didn't bother me as much in Unexpected Journey as it did here, because in Unexpected Journey, they were fleshing out the dwarves, and so that felt much more appropriate to me, because it's like, it is this ensemble cast. Like, you have all these characters together going on a journey together, and so you kind of get to know a lot of them a lot better with the way it's paced in Unexpected Journey. It obviously has its other issues with, like, the White Council scenes hurting the pacing, but here, like, the elves just feel like, and part of this is because I've read the book, so I know, like, the elves are almost, like, are such a non-part of the book. Like, the Rivendell elves have a lot more emphasis on them than the Mirkwood elves, to me, in the book.
So. But they're going to be really important in the Battle of Fire. Because clearly, and this is what makes me so, I'll say that I was going to maybe end the discussion with this, but I'll say it right now. The number one thing I love about Desolation of Smaug is it makes me unbelievably excited for
the movie very well.
And I think all the expansion they're doing is for the Battle of Five Armies. Mm-hmm. And I think that's going to be great, because we have such a deep investment at this point, or at least I do, in Bilbo, in the dwarves, in Gandalf, and now in the elves, and I think, and now in the people of Lake Town, to me, and Bard.
The Lake Town stuff. Well.
And so I think since we have all that, it really excites me for that. And yeah, whether it works on its own in this movie, I think it does, but if you don't think it does, I completely understand. It's a tough situation. I guess, and the thing about Tariel and what I thought worked there is that while the Keely romance is incredibly odd on paper, it worked in person because, for one, I thought Evangeline Lilly and the actor who plays Keely, I'm sorry, I don't remember all 13 dwarves' names, actors. I think it's Aidan Turner, but anyway. That actor who plays Keely and Evangeline Lilly, I liked their chemistry. I thought the writing in their scenes, and particularly for Tariel, the voice of the elves, I think it's Philippa Boyens who does that part of the writing. I've listened to the commentaries. Really well done here. I really like how they write Tariel and those scenes together. And more importantly than any of that, and I guess this is just my foreknowledge, Keely is one of the dwarves who dies.
Yeah.
And they needed to make him into a bigger character before that happened. And they need to, in the next movie, do that to Feely as well.
Mm-hmm.
Because the three dwarves who die, we need to love them. Or have an investment in them by the time they die. And I thought, because he is going to be so central to the emotional arc of this trilogy, having the Tauriel stuff linked to him and helping us to create that emotional investment, I like that as a choice.
Yeah.
But, again, that's so linked to my understanding of the book.
It's like, and it's something that it's like you can't... Like, it's the hardest thing about talking about this movie in particular, because it's the middle chapter of this odd trilogy that it's like... Like, and we can talk about stuff that we like, but, like, nothing has any ultimate payoff. Like we can enjoy scenes on their own, and there you can do that, but it's like, as a full story, like, this middle chapter feels, like, sort of very strange. Like, I feel like it's almost inappropriate to talk about it at all, because it's like, it feels like I stopped watching because of the way they handled the ending, which I don't hate it as much as you, but I'm not a fan of, is like, it feels like I stopped watching a movie and I have to wait a year to start watching it again.
Yeah, it's like I pulled out disc one.
Exactly. Disc two. And then it was like, and then a year from now I'm going to remember, oh shit, I forgot to finish watching Fellowship of the Rings. I should do that now.
Yeah, and that's my problem with the ending of this movie. And I think a lot of these, again, I feel like if they had gone on and done the scene with Smaug in Lake Town, because they have clearly put every character in this movie in place for that scene. They've left Tauriel in Lake Town. They've had Legolas. Legolas maybe not. He's off to fight some orcs.
Yeah.
They've put so many of the characters in place for that. They've built Lake Town up so much. I feel like Bilbo and Thorin's arc in this movie is so linked to what is going to happen because of their folly.
Yeah.
Because of that, that scene being missing is... It annoys me just because this movie is building to it so clearly.
Yeah.
But anyway, let's get back to this. The actual scenes in the Elven King's Hall, I love those sets.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
Really good. I mean, and it's par for the course for Peter Jackson doing good sets off of Tolkien, but it really good work. I liked the prison set in particular. Mm-hmm. But then we get to the barrel scene, and they went all out on this. What did you think?
Like, I thought this was I think probably the barrel scene was my favorite scene in the movie, certainly my favorite action scene, because it was just so... Like, one, because I find... Like, this is something I talked a lot about with Thor 2. I find as I watch more and more movies, I value creativity in action scenes a lot more.
Absolutely.
Like, how many, you know, just, like, straight-up duels have you seen? Or how many just, like, protracted gunfights have you seen in a fucking movie? Like, let's have some crazy goddamn scene where you have 13 dwarves, like, going down in barrels, like, down this fucking river... throwing weapons to each other and fighting orcs as elves come in and, like, Legolas is jumping around and shooting arrows at people. And, like, my favorite part is when, I forget, like, which dwarf they throw to, but they throw an axe to a dwarf who's, like, at the front, and then he chops, like, this log bridge and knocks it down. It's just, like, it's a really...
They're all chopping it, actually.
Yeah. It's a really, just really brilliantly choreographed action scene.
It is, and I think... Yeah. And honestly, I think some of the extra time we spend with the elves in Mirkwood helps this scene, because it feels so cumulatory, where everything that's been in this movie so far comes together in that moment.
Mm-hmm.
All the dwarves are there, all the elves are there, all the orcs are there, and it's just, they're all going crazy. Yeah. And, you know, man, Peter Jackson loves giving Legolas cool moments. And
because it was like, in the Lord of the Rings movies, it felt like he had, like, the one cool thing he did in each movie, and this, and, like, it, like, escalated until, like, in, you know, Return of the King, he single-handedly kills a Mumakil, which is just, like...
And everyone on it.
Yeah. But... And this one, it just felt like every, like, 5 minutes he was on screen and there was an action scene, he got another one of those cool moments.
And I loved it. I think... I really like how Orlando Bloom plays Legolas in this movie.
Yeah, I like it because I forgot how grumpy Legolas is, like, especially, like, around, like, Gimli and stuff in the beginning of Fellowship of the Ring.
And I think...
His character changes so much over the course of those movies that I forgot what old Legolas was like.
And I actually think Legolas has one of the best arcs in this movie where... It's not something you'll get if you're watching this in a vacuum, but if you're thinking of the other movies and stuff, this is the first time Legolas has ever faced a real challenge, is what it feels like. Like, he, in his last scene in the movie, he bleeds for the first time, and you sense that he's really never been injured in battle, has he?
Yeah.
And I like that kind of humbling for him,
mm-hmm.
where it's, he's doing all this cool stuff, but he is a show-off.
Yeah.
And I think that's all kind of implicit, but it's there, and I think it's really interesting. Yeah. And
And I love the part when they first capture the dwarves, and then he's like talking to Glowing, and Glowing has like this amulet with his wife and the picture of Gimli on it. I thought that was a great little.
Well, you know, they did a lot of little prequel callbacks like that in An Unexpected Journey, and I thought most of them were cheesy and didn't work. That one was perfect for me because it wasn't overplayed. Mm-hmm. It was just perfect.
Yeah. And it was because it felt like something, honestly, that could happen because Glowing is Gimli's father. So, you know, why not?
Right. And Legolas, that's the reaction he would have. Mm-hmm. So very funny stuff there. And I think a lot of the action choreography, just with all the characters, it's so character-focused. Like, Legolas moves in a way that is organic to his character. I think Tariel, who has great action choreography, moves in a way that is organic to her character. All the dwarves, same thing.
Yeah.
Like, I love they even give an action beat to Bomber in this movie.
That's great when he's in the fucking barrel
and,
like, he just, like, becomes this, like, death wheel.
It's awesome.
Fucking awesome. Yeah. It's just such a great goddamn action scene.
It is. I love it. And it's not even my... I this is not taking anything away from it. It's not even my favorite in this movie. We'll get to that later on. But it's great. And it's indicative of how a lot of this movie is made, where they take the germ of an idea Tolkien had.
Yeah.
Which is just they go down the river in the barrels. It's not a big action sequence. Mm-hmm. And then they expand it with all this stuff that they've added in, and it just feels so great. It really feels like Peter Jackson owns Middle-earth as much as Tolkien did in a lot of ways now. And those two voices coming together, I think, in Desolation of Smaug, it's a joy to see those two voices intertwined. I really love it. So they get to Lake Town.
Yes.
This is, to me, where the pace of the movie is a little off.
Because
you keep cutting back to elves. You have a lot of Lake Town politics and stuff.
Because this is the part where then Tarja leaves Kirkwood and stuff. This is the part where, like, the elves cutting it bothered me the most, without a doubt.
I liked it all, but I agree the pace is a little off here. But... Bard the Bowman, played by Luke Evans. Awesome, perfect, love that character.
Bard the Bargeman.
Bargeman, so far, sorry.
So they did not call him Bowman yet.
Which is good, that he's going to become the Bowman in a big way.
Yes.
But, no, I really like...
He buys everybody a big bow as a, you know, celebration for defeating Smaug, right? That's why he's called the Bowman.
Yes. Mm-hmm. But I love their Bard. I think they did
he's good.
It's a great character expansion.
Mm-hmm.
You really don't meet Bard in the book, I think, until he fights Smaug. That's when he comes in.
Yeah, not really, yeah.
But, so they've added him in here, and I think Luke Evans is perfect for it, and you feel so bad for Bard if you know what's going to happen, because he just gets fucked by these dwarves.
Yeah, exactly.
Just, his whole life is going to go to shit because of these fucking dwarves.
And I like that they have him realize it and try to stop them going to Smaug, because I think that... will add a lot of some really good tension in the next movie when he obviously has to encounter Thorin.
Well,
Thorin's gone full dick mode.
Right, and I think they set up a lot of that so well here because honestly, I think some of the best writing in the Hobbit book is the Battle of Five Armies and those politics that go into it. And I think that's going to be really interesting in the next movie where Bard is so well established here and he's going to have a real reason to want to fight Thorin and the dwarves.
Yeah.
And be like, give me your gold. You did not earn that.
Yeah.
You motherfuckers. You did not earn that. And I think especially how they picked it in this movie, Bard is going to be in the right.
Yeah.
So it's pretty great stuff there. But what did you... The Lake Town set is fantastic.
Yeah. I mean, you saw a little bit of it at the very beginning of Unexpected Journey in like the flashback sequence.
Yeah.
But I think it's a cool version of Lake Town. I like just the expansion of Lake Town because obviously Lake Town's not... a very, like, fully fleshed out setting in the book, because they kind of just go through it. But any chance I get to see Stephen Fry doing anything, I will take. So,
I like
him be the master of Lake Town.
Stephen Fry is the man. I loved him in this. I didn't so much like his servant. I felt like that was a poor imitation of Wormtongue.
Yeah, he felt like a very cliche character to me, I agree. But he's whatever. He has, like, five lines.
Right. But let's see. So, we have all that stuff in Lake Town. There's a change here when they go to Smaug. Four of the dwarves stay behind. And that's obviously because they want witnesses to the Smaug thing, I think. And I like, you know, so they have Keeley staying behind because he's sick, Feely, whichever one they've pitched as the doctor, and Bofur.
Sylvester McCoy? I don't think he stayed behind.
Not that doctor.
Oh, okay.
Although, we didn't talk about this. Within all this, we do have Gandalf going to meet the doctor.
Yeah.
Or going to meet Radagast the Brown, for those of you who don't know what we're talking about.
Yeah.
I really, really, really liked all of Gandalf's stuff in this movie. Mm-hmm. And I'll tell you, part of it is that they kept it to a minimum. It's not they're constantly cutting to him. His scenes all have weight, and they don't feel protracted in the way I think some of the White Council stuff felt in An Unexpected
Journey. Yeah, I agree that his side story was better handled, because... And then everything he had to do felt really interesting, too, because he's actually going into Dol Guldur and stuff.
And going into those, the tombs, really good scene there. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but I really like Sylvester McCoy in this. He's just got a scene or two, mm-hmm. but good stuff with him. I feel a little mixed about how much magic Gandalf winds up doing when he's in Dol Guldur. Yeah. But overall, I feel okay on it, because I always get this sense that in the books, it's when we don't see Gandalf that he's doing that kind of stuff anyway.
Yeah, and like the nature of the magic I'm more comfortable with.
Yeah.
Yeah, like I've always preferred the interpretation that Gandalf does not cast spells in a traditional sense. Like, that's just never kind of the wizard that he's been. But
yeah.
If it's just he's, like, sort of creating this, like, ball of light or whatever that to, like, fight the shadows, like, that's fine with me.
And I think
he's not shooting lightning bolts at people.
Right, and I think the scene where they reveal Sauron is a great scene.
Yeah, it's just really... Because the whole thing where, like, zooms in and keeps on zooming in, like, fucking cool. Like, weird, but cool.
And in a weird way, it makes me wonder about some of the stuff in An Unexpected Journey, because they spend so much time in the White Council scene and another couple of scenes, seeding all of this. But they seed it in such a way where it seems like everyone is aware the Necromancer is Sauron. I didn't quite get why Gandalf was surprised the Necromancer was Sauron.
Because I don't think they were quite 100, because I feel like it's... Again, I haven't watched An Unexpected Journey since it was in the theaters, but I was under the impression that Gandalf was the one who was most suspicious of that, and most everyone else. Like, Saruman definitely was like, what the fuck are you talking about?
But Gandalf
cannot possibly be Sauron.
Exactly, but that's my point, is that Gandalf is pretty goddamn sure, and then he's surprised.
I wouldn't say he's pretty goddamn sure, he's the most suspicious, but I think you'd still be surprised, because...
They make it more explicit in the extended cut, I'll say that. That's the version I've watched recently, and I don't remember what is and isn't exactly in it, but...
Yeah, because I felt like, especially because, you know, like, Gandalf already dealt with having to fight Sauron the first time around, so I think it's like... I think he would be very reluctant to admit to himself that that's what's fully happened until he's, you know, you can no longer deny it because the dude's fucking standing right there like it's Sauron, man.
It's just, it's a little thing for me, and I think if they had spent less time on that in An Unexpected Journey so that we weren't as prepared for it, that would have surprised me more. Or made me, because, like, I know what they're building to either way.
Yeah, but everybody knows the fucking Necromancer is Sauron.
Right. But, I mean, it's a great scene either way. I think all the stuff in Dol Guldur is really effective and creepy. It's, you know, it's good stuff. And then we end the movie with Gandalf in a cage.
Yeah.
So,
it's, you know, happens to him sometimes.
Yeah.
I wonder if he's going to call some eagles to get him out or something. I don't know.
We shall see. Okay, so that's all the Gandalf side of it.
Yeah.
Ian McKellen, awesome as always.
Yes, of course.
You know, we didn't mention the first scene in the movie. And I really like that scene. Yeah. Where they meet in Bree. And for one, I liked seeing Bree again. Yeah. I liked bringing back Peter Jackson's carrot-eating hobo guy. I liked that. But I like that as a scene. It's just, it's a nice intro.
I agree, yeah.
And it actually did a good job refocusing us on Bilbo at the beginning because of that cut from him saying we're going to need a burglar to Bilbo.
Yeah.
The whole first half of this movie feels very Bilbo-centric to me, and I think that kind of goes away, but... Yeah, anyway. So let's get back. We were talking about Lake Town stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But eventually, anyway, the dwarves go off. They go to the Lonely Mountain.
Yeah.
And from here on out, the movie is just firing on all cylinders.
Yeah.
I think that the journey, for one, you know, I don't like that there is so little location shooting in these movies. I wish there was more. I wish they used New Zealand more. But the scene, you know, the scenes where they are going to the Lonely Mountain, that looks like it is really New Zealand, and it looks awesome. If that Lonely Mountain is an actual mountain in New Zealand, I want to see it.
Yeah.
That is cool.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if it doesn't look CGI to me.
Yeah, but
it's
cool. Who fucking knows these days?
Yeah. So anyway, they go there. It's a lot of good scenes, I think, getting up there on the mountain. There's a lot of just good travel stuff. But really, that scene where they're on the doorstep, perfect version of that scene.
Yeah. But it all is, it's like, you know, because they're all waiting for the key, the hole to show up, and then it doesn't, and then everyone starts to leave, and Bilbo's like, no, guys! It's like, wait, five, God, for fuck's sake. I mean, come on. We've traveled like a year. We traveled across the goddamn planet to get here. Just wait.
Why, like, why wouldn't you just camp out up here anyways? Like, where are you even going?
I think...
Like, read the fucking poem again. It says, when the thrush knocks, assholes. Like, come on.
And the thing is, I think they pitched the scene for you to be aware of all that,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
Because, and I think they've shown enough so far that Thorin is very overly dramatic. That
It does, like, I'm making fun of it, but it makes sense to me within the context of the movie, but it is, like, really frustrating. Like,
oh, yeah.
Guys! Like, for fuck's sake! Seriously!
No, it's totally that, and I think you can feel that in Bilbo, and I think Martin Freeman has some great stuff in that scene, and I think the... This is some of my favorite stuff in the score on the soundtrack, where Bilbo, you know, gets it, figures it out, and they go in, and the music when Thorin enters with Balin, and that that emotional upheaval, it really, that to me is one of the scenes that is on par with Lord of the Rings.
Mm-hmm.
Great, great stuff.
Yeah.
And then Bilbo's got to go talk to a dragon.
Yeah.
What did you think of Smaug and the encounter with Smaug?
I thought it's a fucking awesome version of Smaug, especially like the CGI is spectacular. Like, it is an awesome fucking dragon.
Here's what I love visually about Smaug, and we'll talk about the performance in a minute. Visually, I love that his face is so recognizably Smaug. He looks not only like the Alan Lee illustrations, he kind of looks like the animated Smaug from the movie.
Yeah, it's a similar style, yeah.
But...
He doesn't have, like, the big, like, whiskers and stuff.
But I almost...
Not quite as good as that
Smaug. But I remember him having them, because otherwise he's very similar. Yeah. But here's where they changed his design, and this is what makes him awe-inspiring, is the size. It's incredible. When that scene, when you see him coming up on one side of the screen, and they use the entire widescreen frame to see his tail coming up on the other, and you realize, oh, that's what they're going for with this. And
he's a fucking dragon. Dragons are big.
And, oh, I mean, that entire set, you realize, was built and or illustrated in the way it is to accompany his or to accommodate his size. And his size really is kind of terrifying. I mean, this is... I feel like, you know, I've seen every kind of movie dragon. I'm not going to be ever, you know, unsettled by a dragon on screen again. Smaug fucking terrifies you, you know?
Yeah.
He's intimidating. And Martin Freeman is so good in that scene, just barely keeping it together.
Yeah.
As Bilbo. And that's where I think Benedict Cumberbatch's work comes in. Mm-hmm. Because I love how much he hones in on the intelligence of Smaug.
Yeah.
That Smaug is terrifying because he's big, but even more so, you know, we've established Bilbo as one of the cleverer people in Middle-earth at this point. But he's no match for Smaug, even verbally, because Smaug just knocks him down every time. And I really like that side of the character.
Yeah. Their version of Smaug, I think, is just incredible.
It's up there with Gollum, to me.
Yeah, it's a great realization of the character sort of physically in a digital realm, and then the vocal performance by Benedict Cumberbatch is awesome.
And what do you think he mo-capped? What was he mo-capping?
I've seen the pictures on the internet of him, like, snarling with dots on his face, so I know. I don't know how you translate a human snarl into a dragon's face, because, hey, dragons look a lot different from humans, especially the facial structure, but...
Yeah. I mean, I'm sure there's some explanation, and I can't wait to get...
I like in my head of him just, like, you know, in a mo-cap room, just, like, jumping around on all fours, like, trying to pretend he's a dragon, like, crawling on piles of gold.
It's just Peter Jackson, like, punking him. They don't even use it. It's just...
Yeah.
No, it's good. And I think, that whole scene is really well done. And then they take... There's a very big shift from Tolkien here, where, you know, the dwarves come in, and the whole climax of this movie, what turns out to be the climax, I thought it was kind of the beginning of the climax, but the climax of this movie is the dwarves fighting Smaug.
Mm.
And this is actually my favorite action sequence in the movie, because I think that same kind of creative spirit is there, as in the barrel sequence to me. And even more so to me, they've established Smaug so well by the time the dwarves come in, and they've established Thorin's character so well, and what he has against Smaug. And I think then the idea of, actually, how would you fight a dragon with these tools at your disposal? Yeah. And I think it's such a creative realization of that. You can't.
Fucked.
No. And I think it's such a creative realization of that, and I think it feels so apocalyptic and big, but also character-focused. And really getting to explore Erebor through this fight with Smaug, I really love that as a climax. It just... it's phenomenal to me.
Yeah, like, actually, like... I do really like the scene. I think it goes on too long for me.
Okay.
Like, and I think if I rewatched the movie, I don't think I'd have that problem with it, because in the back of my mind, one of the reasons why I felt it was too long is because, having read the book, like, I was expecting the movie to carry on into Smaug going out into Lake Town. So I was like, why are we spending so much time? Because, you know, like, that whole... Because how the scene plays out in the book is just a battle of wits between Bilbo and Smaug. And then Smaug's like, peace, I'm out of here. I'm going to go fucking eat some people and burn down that entire village.
I want to hear Benedict Cumberbatch say what you just said in Smaug's voice.
Yeah, but... And so, like, it felt a little weird to me because it's one of my favorite scenes in the book because it is very much, you know, it's a lot like the Gollum sequence, Riddles in the Dark.
Right.
And so having this whole huge action scene, obviously it is appropriate here, but it does kind of feel like, as an adaptation for the book, like if you put in a big fight scene between Bilbo and Gollum
scene.
So it's like, because it feels like it steals some of the focus away from what was the Battle of Wits, and now it's just... Everyone's fighting this dragon. But again, I think if I rewatched the movie, I might not have a problem with it at all if I was expecting it to happen.
And you actually reminded me, because I'm kind of talking from my second viewing, I had that exact same problem you had the first time I saw it. I did think it went on too long. Exactly what you just said, that's what I was feeling about it when I was watching it the first time. Second time for me, that was not my favorite scene in the movie at all the first time I watched it. I thought it was really good and I praised it in my review, just on a technical level, but it was the second time I watched it where that scene worked for me, because I didn't have any expectation going on. And when you watch it that way, you realize, okay, it is being pitched as the climax to this movie. It does work in that sense. But either time, I really love the focus on what a kind of weirdly cathartic release this is for Thorin and the dwarves.
That they finally get a chance to just kind of fight the motherfucker.
And the scene where they, you know, Thorin is on top of the statue and they unleash it and he says, you know, we will have our revenge. You just want to go, oh yeah! Like that, it's just, they pitch it so perfectly.
And it was like, and it was so much so that, like, in the back of my head I was like, are they changing how you killed? Like, that doesn't make any sense. Like, I thought for, like, a brief second that they actually changed how they killed Smaug. It's like, but they already built up the arrow thing. Right. What the fuck? It's like, oh, okay. No.
Smaug's younger brother will come in. And,
No. Smaug.
But okay, so we have that great scene. Then Smaug flies out and says, I am death. And Bilbo says, what have we done? And we cut to black and I threw my 3D glasses at the screen. What about you?
I was like, huh, that's kind of weird.
Yeah.
That was my reaction to it. Okay. Like, I didn't, because I don't think it was... Like, I was expecting the movie to carry on for most of it, but by the time when... But I did kind of get the sense when Smaug was flying out, and then, like, the music kind of, like, goes down a bit, and then, like,
I did, but
Bilbo, I was like, okay, so this is where they're ending the movie. That's kind of weird.
I did, but that whole sense was like, I was like, don't do it. You're not actually gonna... No, don't, and then cut to black, I'm like, motherfucker.
It didn't... I don't know, it didn't really... drive me up the wall. I am curious, like, how it does seem like a weird thing, particularly for the beginning of the next movie, but I have no idea how they're going to handle that, so we'll see. But yeah, it didn't like make me furiously angry or anything. Okay. as a choice in adaptation,
it upset me the first time I watched it, and the second time I watched it, you know, I didn't get mad or anything the second time because I knew it was coming. But just from kind of an academic angle, just examining the second half of the movie, which was going to be the first half of the second movie in their original plan and how they shot it, it very, very much feels like they're building to that. Just every scene. That was going to be the next scene. It really feels like we're just waiting for that next scene. It's like what you said. Like, the movie just... They ended disc one.
Yeah.
You got to put in disc two. And, you know, again, it will not be as big a problem when the third movie's out and we can watch it. Although it will be that thing where I feel like you're going to have to watch Desolation of Smaug in close proximity to There and Back Again, or There and Back Again may feel really weird.
Yeah, well, definitely.
Yeah. Like, you know, this is a different kind of comparison, but Harry Potter and the Deathly Hallows Part 2, that movie to me, every time I watched it in close proximity to Part 1.
Yeah, yeah. It is exactly like the split, to me at least, between Deathly Hallows Part 1 and Part 2, of like, okay, I guess we're just stopping the movie now. Like,
yeah. And I guess to me, this was even more frustrating, at least on the level where I felt like Deathly Hallows Part 1 resolved its own climax. And this does not. Yeah. This is a cliffhanger. And that cliffhangers kind of annoy me in this way. But it is the same thing. Like, the one time I have watched Deathly Hallows Part 2 away from Part 1, it's the weirdest thing in the world.
Yeah,
and I feel like There and Back Again might be that way too. But it's, you know, when they're all three out and you can do the big marathon viewing, it'll be fun. But, you know. Overall, I feel like I don't want to focus on this too much because I really, really love Desolation of Smaug. Mm-hmm. It's in my top 30. My next best 20 are not ranked. But I think this would have been in, you know, in my top 15 of the year, just because I think overall what it does well, it does so incredibly well for me.
Yeah.
And I think it comes, you know, the Hobbit movies to me are not on the level of Lord of the Rings at all, but there are moments in here that come close. And overall, just the feeling of Peter Jackson really working at the top of his game was really invigorating to me. And I feel like There and Back Again may get to that level of Lord of the Rings to me, and that level of emotional investment and grandeur. So that's kind of my thoughts. What else do you want to say about it?
Yeah, like, I think, like, this movie just sort of, to me, it makes a trade-off with, like, kind of like the first movie, like this balance between character and action. And it's actually, it's very similar to kind of Fellowship of the Ring and The Two Towers in that way, where Fellowship of the Ring is a heavily character-focused movie, and then Two Towers has character stuff in it, obviously, like, you kind of can't not have it, but it's, Two Towers is much more focused on the action side of it, and Desolation of Smaug is very much that compared to Unexpected Journey. And so since I like the character stuff more, Unexpected Journey is not a better movie, but I think I kind of like it more because I like the stuff it's, and it's got the Riddles in the Dark sequence, which is my favorite scene in the book by far. Like, the Riddles in the Dark chapter in the book is my favorite thing in all the Middle-earth, Lord of the Rings, to everything stuff. So.
And they hit it out of the park.
Yeah, exactly. So,
yeah, and I think, for me, it's an Unexpected Journey. You know, I like that movie. Desolation of Smaug, I guess, is just richer to me in so many ways, where I understand what you say about the character stuff, but I think they go much further with Thorin in this movie than they did in the first movie.
Yeah, but part of the problem with that, though, is that his stuff is not fully realized yet, because it's his descent turning into the grand asshole he is during the Battle of Five Armies. And they do a good job of that, especially, I like how you get this sense, especially because in Lake Town, you know, because Thorin is, he's so regal, and because he is a king, but he's forced to do all this not kingly shit, like when they're in Lake Town and they're stealing weapons and they get caught. And I think you get this subtle sense every time that happens, every time they get captured by, like, the elves and the orcs and the Lake Town people, then the back of his mind, Thorin's just like, I'm a fucking king, goddammit. Like, why am I having to do this stuff? I do think that's handled really well, but we don't get the payoff yet in this movie. And it's like, in Unexpected Journey, you very much get the payoff on that character arc for Bilbo. Like it is. And that's very satisfying to me in a way that, like, this is such a middle chapter that you don't get that kind of satisfaction from watching it alone.
And I see that, and I guess I just can't separate it from my knowledge of the book, so I'm still with this analytical mind of, I know where it's going, so I'm completely okay with it. And it's a weird thing to try to separate that, but I think at least what we get in this movie from Thorin, I feel, is so rich. From Bilbo, when he's there, is so good. Martin Freeman has just some scenes in this movie that are amazing. Like, there's that little moment where Gandalf says, you know, what did you find in the caves?
Yeah.
And how Martin Freeman plays that scene is heart-wrenching.
Yeah, Martin Freeman is fucking fantastic as Bilbo. Like,
yeah.
That was what made the first movie work for me, so.
Yeah. Right, and I think, you know, I wish he was in this one more, but I love what we get with him. And all the other characters, I think they keep making the dwarves more interesting to me. I think Tariel is a great character, and I think Evangeline Lilly is going to be a movie star after this. She's phenomenal in that kind of movie star capacity. I think the stuff with Bard the Bowman is so...
Bard the Bargeman.
Bard the Bargeman is so compelling to me, and kind of building Lake Town as this character. And I think Smaug is so well realized as a villain and a character. So to me, this is just a richer movie, even though it does not work for me as a movie. Whereas an Unexpected Journey, it feels slight. It feels very slight, but it works for me as a movie.
Yeah. And honestly, I'm fond of its slightness, because that is, I don't know, it kind of feels more in keeping with the way those books are written to me, that, like, it feels less like a movie to me, and I kind of like that in a weird way. Because it's almost like, what if the Lord of the Rings movies had been... And it's very different because the Lord of the Rings books are so much denser, but, like, what if those movies had been much more literal adaptations of the books, and, like...
Right, like,
adapted, like, the pacing of the books a lot more. The Hobbit feels a lot more paced like a book to me.
If the first Lord of the Rings ended with, like, them leaving Tom Bombadil.
Exactly, yeah. It kind of feels like that. And it's like, I kind of like having that. Like, I kind of like having both of those versions.
At the same time, I also thought Desolation of Smaug did better by some of the tonal inconsistencies
Unexpected Journey had. Yeah, that's definitely true.
And I think, there's little things like that. The CGI did not bother me as much in this movie.
But I think that's because maybe you were expecting it, because I don't, like, and all of those, okay, but Smaug is, like, on Gollum level, so they both had that's their what really I was good CGI.
Yeah, but that's the thing, is that the climax of An Unexpected Journey is, okay, you have Gollum, but you also have all the goblins and shit, and that all looks so artificial. There are parts of this movie that absolutely look too artificial to me. But overall, I think all the sets in this movie have kind of this mix of artificial and real, and it feels more balanced to me. You know, Azog still looks stupid, and I think one of my major complaints about this movie, actually, is that I think they cut away to the orcs way too many times.
Yeah, I agree.
We never...
It feels really weird, like, I don't understand why they need to do that.
We do not need to see the orcs on their own.
Yeah, exactly. It's so fucking weird that we're getting, like, all this stuff with, like, just the orcs. That, like, you got that occasionally. Like, you'd get, like, one scene in a Lord of the Rings movies where it did that establish, like, Lurtz and his Uruk-hai chasing down the party. Like, that was, like, it, you know?
And usually those were contextualized with Saruman being there.
Exactly.
Yeah. So, that's a little weird. You know, like An Unexpected Journey, I think there's a couple little scenes you could trim out of this one.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I feel like, overall, you know, this movie moves so well. It never really slows down. We should talk really quickly. High frame rate, still controversial.
Yeah.
What did you think of it second time?
Yeah, I still really like it, obviously. Yeah. Like, I still think it is the way to watch these movies if you can, you know, bring yourself to accept it.
Yeah, and I mean, I saw it both in 24 frames per second 3D, which is awful. Yeah, don't look at it that way.
Definitely don't see that.
No, that's a waste of... That's what they showed it to critics in. I don't get that.
Yeah.
Just show it in 2D to critics, you know? Just do that.
For God's sakes.
But no, then I saw it in high frame rate, and I think the high frame rate is the way to go. You know, I think it looks even better in some ways in this movie. Like, they had even more time to get everything looking right from an effects angle. But there's just so many camera pans.
Exactly.
And complex camera movements.
Especially, I think, like, the barrel scene. Like, I only watched it in high frame rate, so I can't say this for sure, but in the back of my mind, watching the barrel scene in particular, I was like, the way this scene is shot, like, all the moving parts, it would look like a blurry mess to me in 24 frames.
I mean, yeah, and I don't think it looks like a blurry mess, but it looks so much better in high frame rate. It's like, no comparison. And, you know, there are pluses and minuses. I think, for me, high frame rate is it looks great. I love the smoothness and how they can do more with the camera and effects. You know, it means there is no texture to the image anymore, though. There are texture to faces and objects. As an image, it doesn't have that anymore. And that's, you know, that's kind of a trade-off, but I feel like if we're going to be shooting movies digitally anyway, digital photography rarely has a texture. Do this. This is better.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and so overall, you know, my preference of how film looks is still that filmic 35mm look. But I feel like if we're evolving, it's the same thing I said last year. High frame rate is the better way to do it if we're going to evolve.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Peter Jackson is proving that because
he's... Yeah, especially if, like, you know, it's clear to me that... Because he shot the movies with high frame rate in mind is the way to watch the movie. Yeah.
And, and there are a lot more theaters showing it now. I was surprised. Warner Brothers expanded. You can see it at pretty much any theater that has it in 3D. You can see it in high frame rate.
Yeah.
Check on Fandango before you go.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, if you know, just give it a chance. And I think, Sean, you said the right thing to get me in the right mindset for it last year. So what advice would you give to people if they're still reluctant?
The number one thing is to be willing to accept it. Like, it's going to be weird at first, probably. Like, some people are not going to notice it. It kind of depends on how many movies you watch and how, like your mindset. But it's going to seem weird at first. In particular, it's going to seem like it's moving fast because you're seeing twice the amount of images in the same amount of time, and so your brain is going to interpret that as faster movement. But just tell yourself that's not what it is. You know, the same amount of time is elapsing. You're just seeing things moving a lot smoother than you're used to in a movie, and that's all that's happening. And just be willing to accept that. You know, sort of take control of your own prejudices in watching film, and be willing to accept something new and different. And within like 5 minutes, you're not going to notice it. Like, you're not going to notice the fast movement of it at all. You're just going to be able to accept it. That's what happened for me, at least.
Yeah, you have to mentally prepare yourself because you are. Your brain is wired after, you know, a lifetime of watching movies at a set frame rate. It's wired to see that. Mm-hmm. And it's not wired to see this. It just isn't. And you've got to kind of coax your brain into getting to that point. And so, you know, I didn't have any of that in mind the first time I saw it. And it just distracted me and it didn't... I never settled into it.
Yeah.
And if you can get yourself to a point where you can settle into it and tell yourself it's going to be different, but maybe different is okay.
Yeah.
Or maybe even good, you know? That's really where you've got to go with it. So, you definitely check it out that way if you've only seen it in 24 frames.
Yeah.
It's if nothing else, it's cool. Like, it's a cool, it's a different thing, even if you don't like it.
Yeah. You've never seen anything like that before unless you saw An Unexpected Journey like it. Mm-hmm. And some people may not have had the opportunity to see An Unexpected Journey like it. Yeah, because
it was only in a few theaters around here, at least.
Yeah. So, okay. Anything else to say about Desolation of Smaug, or should we move on?
I liked it.
I liked it, too. All right. Two thumbs up.
Yes.
All right. So, now let's talk about some Doctor Who.
Doctor Who.
So, The Time of the Doctor, Christmas Day. This was the Christmas special for 2013, last episode for Matt Smith. We're going to talk about the episode a little bit, then we'll move into kind of an 11th Doctor retrospective. Okay. We both like the 11th Doctor.
Yes. I think that is safe to say, yes.
Yes. So, Sean, literally, we have not exchanged a word about this yet.
Yeah, I have no idea.
No idea.
How you feel about it.
What did you think?
I liked it. I liked it more than most people. I am just as... You were giving me this amazing
Oh, my God! I thought you were going to detest this episode.
So did I! In the back of my mind watching it, because I've seen it, I've watched it twice now, and in the back of my mind when watching it, I was like, I should hate this, because there are a lot of... There's a lot of things about this that, like, the problems of the stuff that, like, shared with a lot of, like, the Stephen Moffat finale episodes that I really despise, but I did not despise it. And I have my reasons.
Okay. I had mixed feelings about it.
Yeah.
I did not hate it on any level.
Yeah.
But I think the last scene is perfect.
Yeah.
The last scene
If they had not had that last scene, I would have hated this fucking episode so much.
No, I agree. And But it does. So it's like, you can't...
Yeah. But that was, like, going into it, I was like... If Matt Smith's last scene on Doctor Who is him in old age makeup, I am going to fucking break my TV right now.
I'm
going to
go find Stephen Moffat and punch him.
Like, what are you thinking? God damn it!
No, when it aired, Thomas and I were my brother and I were watching it, and there's that last scene where he's got the old age makeup, and I said, "Do not let that be his last scene." And then when he walks into the TARDIS, and I'm like, "Okay, thank God,
thank God." Yeah,
but no, okay,
he gets a proper send off.
Right. So mixed feelings. I love the last scene. Yeah. I thought a lot of the stuff in the first 20-30 minutes is great, and it's really funny in the beginning. There's some really funny stuff. I think Matt Smith is terrific. I think Jenna Coleman is spectacular in this episode. I think she covers up some of the sins in the writing to me amazingly. I think she's really good in this, and I don't want to sell her short, because I think while they are still catching up to her on writing Clara, she is giving one of the best performances Modern Who has had in a lead role to me. Absolutely. She's great. I thought the story to me felt like... I like all the resolutions we get to the Matt Smith era. I think they're all...
I like that we just get them. Like, it's kind of really sort of throwaway for most of it, but it's like...
Well, but that's my...
Thank God that it's at least, like, it's settled now, you know?
And I liked that, but a lot of it felt a little checklisty to me.
Yeah, it did.
And I thought...
But at this point, there's no other way to do it. Like, no. You just have to be like... We just have to address the fact that this shit has not been addressed yet in 3 years.
And I think the story was interesting. I thought it felt a little messy for 1 hour. Yeah. I thought
it needed more time.
I thought putting Matt Smith in old age makeup for his last episode was weird to me. And I thought Matt Smith did as well as he could with that, but I thought he had to play it in an affected way that did not quite fit his performance style.
I actually really liked how he played, because I thought he brought a lot of like William Hartnell into old Doctor that I
liked. Old Doctor, mid-age Doctor, I thought was weird. But I've only watched the episode once, I want to say that.
I watched it again last night to try to, like, understand myself more about why I liked it.
Okay, and And here's the thing. The more I think about the episode, the more I like it. And most of the things I thought were awkward in the moment have faded from me. And I think it does a lot of really interesting things.
Yeah.
And so, I don't know. I'm conflicted about it. I don't think it's a great regeneration story, but I don't think it's bad.
Yeah, it's not. I don't think it's... When I said I liked it, I don't think it's amazing.
Okay.
I liked it a lot more than I was expecting. Like, it's definitely better than The Name of the Doctor to me. It's definitely better than The Wedding of River Song to me. Like, I was kind of afraid going into this episode, because I was like, the track record Moffat has had on his finales has not been good other than Pandora Opens and The Big Bang. So it's like... You know, we've got like a 33% chance of it being good based on past stuff. So
I honestly just want to hear you talk, because I'm really fascinated. I thought the whole episode, I'm like, Sean's going to hate this. Sean's going to hate this.
Should get out of the way what is simultaneously the best and worst thing. What could be the best thing, but what is definitely the worst thing about this episode is it's when it says Doctor Who in succession about 50 fucking times. That drove me, like, I literally, like, groaned. Just like, ah! Just stop fucking saying Doctor Who, but maybe it's finally done. You know, maybe this was Moffat getting it completely out of his system. It's like, it's over, and nobody will ever say Doctor Who on Doctor Who ever again.
I had a similar reaction. So I groaned, just like you said. I thought it annoyed me, but I thought all the story revolving around that and how they dealt with the cracks and the Time Lords, I really liked that, actually.
Yeah, no, I liked the plot of it, the idea of it, but just...
No, I agree.
Them saying it was like...
Stop.
Like, yeah, driving a fucking nail into my head. It just... Because I was explaining this to my mom, because when I was watching the episode, because we watched it on Christmas, and they started doing that, and my mom was sort of like walking around in the kitchen behind me because I was at my parents' house when it was airing, obviously because it was Christmas.
Right.
And like they started saying Doctor Who, and my mom's not really interested in Doctor Who, but she knew I was watching Doctor Who, and back in my mind, like I was embarrassed that I was watching this show, and then the show's just parroting its title over and over and over again, and like someone else can hear it. Like it was just like, it felt like I was watching porn, you know? It's just like, I can't, what is, oh god, like should I mute the TV right now? Like this is so, it was like stressful for me because it was like, this is so dumb. It's the kitschiest, dumbest thing. And then thinking about someone else walking in and hearing that, like if my first exposure to Doctor Who was me walking into a room knowing that someone in the room was watching Doctor Who and then just hearing from the TV, Doctor Who, Doctor Who, Doctor Who, I would have laughed, probably slapped that person, and never seen them again for the rest of my life because they had the audacity to watch a show that would fucking do that. Because it's so dumb.
Okay, well, what did you like?
Okay. Most everything else. I mean, I think what really held the episode together for me is that both Matt Smith and Jenna Louise Coleman are fucking great. Like, that, if their performances had not been up to snuff, I think this episode would have really fallen apart because the episode is so dense. Like most Moffat finales, he packs in so much story. But I think the key thing that I kind of came... The conclusion I came to when I watched it the second time about why him packing so much story into this did not bother me as much as it did with the other ones, because this episode is still incredibly busy like the other finales he's done. But one of the key things is I think there's a difference in tone, and I think like the fact that it takes place over a hugely protracted period of time, like literally centuries, that the busyness of it makes sense to me because it has, I think, a very sort of epic tone. And
it does.
I mean that like in the traditional actual proper sense of it being like an epic, of the storytelling being kind of sparse in a way of it, like, you know, it's telling these very grand events and these very sort of almost like kind of like the way The Hobbit is written, and these very like sort of sparse general details, but trying to get at the core of what it's saying through those sparse details. And I think it, you know, it didn't pull it off perfectly, but I think it pulled it off well. Like, I think it worked for me in that sense, in a way that like The Wedding of River Song is just busy because Moffat didn't know how to handle it. It's like this one just feels busy because it needs to be busy because it's dealing with so much stuff and it's dealing it with it in a very sort of Spartan way.
And this also has a very clear through line, though.
Yeah.
Which Reading of River Song doesn't. It has ten different stories that don't relate to each other. And, you know, Name of the Doctor is actually very simple, but it's got silly stuff in it, you know, that kind of thing. I agree with you on that. And I think it threw me for a loop in the moment. And I did.
Yeah, definitely the first time I watched it, I was a little bit confused, especially when I realized. Like, the one thing I think they needed to handle better is the first time you realize that the Doctor is staying on this planet for, like, 300 years, and, like, he comes back, it's like, oh, he's, like, aged now. Like, they needed to handle that transition specifically better to you moving into, like, the second half of the episode where you need to get into this mode of, like, this is how this story is transitioning now. Like, that transition is not elegant in any way.
And I think if you had like just 10 extra minutes and you just devoted it to his life on Trensalore, that would have helped.
You mean in the town of Christmas?
The town of Christmas, yes.
This is like,
is that
this
one of...
just did not need to be a Christmas episode. Like, they could, you know, you can air an episode on Christmas and not have any reference to Christmas whatsoever. Like, that would be totally fine, you know? It doesn't have, you don't have to fucking name the town Christmas if that's the extent you need to go to Christmas theme your episode.
I will say it was worth it to me because there's a really good joke about that where she says, how can you name a town Christmas? She says, I don't know, how can you have an island called Easter?
That
made me laugh, so I'm okay with it.
But it just felt like the most, just like, Moffat had no idea how to turn this into Christmas. Like, it felt like he turned in the script to the BBC, and the BBC were like, this is a Christmas special, Stephen Moffat. Like, you need to make it a Christmas special. So he's like, okay, fine. Town's called Christmas. Like, let's fucking shoot this thing.
Right. Okay. So, no, and I think from a story level, and here's where I have thought higher of the episode since I watched it. I think the idea of that, you know, the general plot is, you know, the Doctor goes to Trenzalore, realizes this whole thing with the Time Lords and the crack and this big standoff, and he stays there. In the moment,
that
it
was like the worst description of the plot. Like, I don't think there was a complete sentence in that entire description of the plot.
Should I try it again?
Yes.
Okay.
One more time.
Okay. I'm going to try to do it in multiple sentences this time.
All right, there you go.
Okay.
Instead of zero sentences.
There's this message coming from Trenzalore. All the different races that the Doctor has fought are congealing there, including this sort of that papal thing from season 6.
Yeah, the papal mainframe. Yeah.
Right, and so the Doctor goes there too. He learns about those cracks in the universe from series 5 are still lingering, and that part of the explanation we haven't seen so far is that the Time Lords are trying to get through because they are alive again after Day of the Doctor.
Yeah,
and so the Doctor does not want to sacrifice his own people, but he also does not want to let this Time War start again.
Yeah.
So he lets this standoff perpetuate, and he decides to stay on Trenzalore for however long it takes to let the situation settle.
Yeah.
Basically. And he's fighting all his enemies. And in any case, I think... So that story, it's very big, it's very epic, very Spartan in the way you described it. And it threw me for a loop when I was watching it, but the more I think about it, I think it fits very well with the 11th Doctor's character. Mm-hmm. He is the kind of Doctor who would do this, because he does not care about time so much in terms of how much time he has to spend on something. Mm-hmm. He is very devoted to doing what he feels is right in the moment, but he also has this kind of myth-making sense to him. Mm-hmm. And that goes in line with Stephen Moffat's writing over the 11th Doctor era, but he does get involved in these big stories and big campaigns. And it feels right that he would say, if he feels like he knows he's dying, he would devote the end of his life to trying to save this town.
Yeah.
Like, I like that line he has about, every life is a victory for me.
Yeah.
That is the 11th Doctor.
Yeah, because because that scene very succinctly explains why he's been staying there the whole time. It's just because if he left, they would destroy the entire planet to try to keep the Time Lords from coming out. And it's like, of course he can't fucking let that happen.
Right. And so I think that fits. And I really like that the more and more I think about it. And I like that as his last story.
Yeah.
And I also like, well, I think some of the checklist stuff where we have, you know, this is how the TARDIS exploded. This is how this happened. This is how this happened. This is how the Silence were created. This is how Madame Covarian went back in time.
Yeah.
It feels a little checklisty, but I really do like the idea for this specific Doctor and this era of the show. I like the idea that all of his problems he faced over his life started from something he did at the end of his life.
Yeah, yeah. Like, I agree. And I like the idea of it being the Time Lords coming back is, like, sufficiently big enough to make it feel like, yes, like, this is something that important. Yeah, I definitely agree that, like, the idea of it is really good, but it is obviously, like, in the execution, like, there's nothing you can do. Like, it was just...
Here's something you could have done.
Yes, what?
If Moffat really knew all this ahead of time...
Yes, if he had known it ahead of time, there'd be stuff you could do.
The explanation... This is the only thing that really bothered me on a checklist level was... Okay, so we explained Madame Covarian went back in time, and that's why that happened. I don't mind that being thrown out there, because we saw Series 6. That makes sense that that's how this emanated. But the explanation that it was Madame Covarian and her order that blew up the TARDIS, why didn't we see that in Series 6?
Yeah, I don't know.
We didn't need to know why she did it. That's okay, leaving that for later. But that should have been dramatized somewhere in Series 6. I dare say they could have built a finale around that.
Maybe. Who knows?
Because we did see, and I actually had forgotten some of this. My brother recently rewatched Series 5.
Yeah, I marathoned all of the Matt Smith stuff leading up to watching
this
episode. So.
Yeah,
so that's sort of also my mindset going into it, is literally I, like, rewatched the 50th anniversary, like, 30 minutes before this aired. So.
Okay. So, yeah, so we've seen that we saw the TARDIS explode in Series 5, but that explanation could have been given more in context in Series 6. But, you know,
that's kind of like, because I wasn't thinking about that, like, it would have been nice to, like, know how, like had that been, like, shown in some way of, like, what the fuck they even did to blow up the, like, how the, do you even do that? How do you blow up the TARDIS? Who knows?
Yeah. But, I mean, I still like all the explanations, and I think they make sense. And overall, the way this contextualizes some of the Matt Smith era makes me think more highly of it in a weird way. Not that, like, the whole thing feels more complete now, you know?
Yeah.
Like, I don't have to look at Series 6 and be like, Like, and I like Series 6 very, very much because it's got a ton of good episodes. But that kind of unfinished quality because of Wedding of River Song, I feel a little less annoyed by now.
Yeah, and same for me, like thinking back to the end of the Big Bang where it's like they, like, you realize, wait, shit, we don't know anything about anything. Like, all we know is that the TARDIS blew up, but nothing else behind that. And, like, just the vague, silence will fall. It's like, God damn it. And then they didn't bring it up, like, ever again until now. And then they're just like, they throw out a sentence. But hey, with a sentence, sometimes that's enough.
No, a sentence can be enough, and, you know, it worked. But what else did you like about this episode? I've been talking for a while. I want to throw it back to you.
Let's see, what were some of the... I mean, okay, one of the things I really liked is you talked about it being a really fitting end for the 11th Doctor. But one of the things I really liked is, even though I don't necessarily agree with this being the Doctor's last incarnation, you know, like traditionally going back to the 12 regeneration limit from Deadly Assassins, the way this episode is sort of played, you do get the sense of it being almost like the... It's not just, you know, the finale for the 11th Doctor, but the finale for that Doctor, you know, like, and I thought that idea of that Doctor ultimately coming to a place where the noblest thing he can do is stay somewhere, is just to finally be like, okay, I'm going to stay here and I'm going to grow old. Like, that is, like, the biggest sacrifice he can possibly make. And I thought that was... There's just something about that idea that even if the execution is not quite right, me having watched 50 years worth of Doctor Who, and like that being that idea, I think is so good as a culmination for that character, in a sense that, like, that just being so good for me is like that elevates it so much, because, like, you know, it's the exact opposite of the Doctor Who thing. The idea of me having watched 50 years of Doctor Who, and then now you're making his name this huge fucking deal that still doesn't 100% make sense. It's still super dumb that you're, like, bringing that up. That's terrible. But, like, this very sort of organic, he has come to a place where he can stay somewhere, which is the one thing we have never seen the Doctor be able to do. I thought that was really well done. And then, plus, it's also seeded really well throughout the 11th Doctor's run, where, you know, having marathoned all of it, where the 11th Doctor very much starts out in a place where he's almost he's like kind of like Tom Baker in the sense of like how insistent he is on not sticking around anywhere, where it's like it drives him fucking insane when he's in the lodger and stuff. It's just like he can't just like settle down anywhere. But Amy and Rory specifically, since he spends so much fucking time with them because they're like basically his companions for almost his entire run, he becomes so fond of them that you do get the sense over his run of like him learning a little bit about how to settle through being with them and his like extreme fondness for them.
Yeah. And I will say, you giving that explanation right now makes me think so much more highly of this episode. And it's not something I'd thought of, because, and I think I wish I had marathoned the Matt Smith era, because I think in context, I think it's going to work, because I think
if I hadn't done that, I would not have liked this episode at all, probably. But, like, okay, me being in that mindset is definitely, like, I think contributed to me liking it. Yeah.
Okay, that's good. And, you know, and that's really, and I do think it's a very thoughtful episode in a lot of ways. I think Stephen Moffat put an awful lot of thought into how he wanted this era to go out.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, as I agree, executionally, there are things that could have been done better.
Yeah.
But those are kind of minor in the end. Mm-hmm. But the ideas are really good.
Yeah.
The ideas are really good. And I do agree, Matt Smith, when he is in the extreme old age makeup, I don't love the makeup necessarily.
Yeah, but it's better than the makeup in Prometheus, so...
Anything is better than the makeup in Prometheus, Sean. But, no, I think his performance is very good there, and I agree about the William Hartnell comparison. Yeah. And I just, there's some scenes there that are great. Like, I love when Clara comes in and knows he's dying. Yeah. And she reads that poem about the clock, basically.
Yeah.
And it's such a nice scene. And I think...
Yeah, there are a lot of really, really nice touches about, like, you know, like, the way they convey how old the Doctor has become is the fact that he can't pull that Christmas cracker all the way because he just doesn't have the strength in his hand anymore.
That's
like,
heartbreaking.
Yeah, there are a lot of really, really smart touches like that. And then... Like, one of, like, the best scenes in the whole thing, even though, like, it could have been built up a little bit more, but I think it kind of works in its execution, is earlier when Clara first comes back and the Doctor's sort of in that middle-aged stage and he handles his Cyberman head.
I love that scene.
And then the Cyberman head, Handles, dies and the Doctor's like, Handles, and he sort of, like, shakes it. Like, it's a... Handel's had, like, one scene earlier on, and so it's like, he is not that well built up, but Matt Smith plays it so well that it's like, it doesn't matter that you had no attachment to Handel's, it's just so obvious that he had a huge amount of attachment to Handel's. And then Handel's is also just a great name for a Cyberman head. Like, I thought that was fucking hilarious.
There's a lot of good humor in this. There's early on, you know, his first couple scenes with Handel's in the before the theme song. All the stuff with Clara and his exchanges with her and him being naked in the TARDIS. It's like, I have to go to church.
Yeah.
And those jokes. And then I think the working in Matt Smith's baldness made for a funny little scene.
Yeah, the fact that he cut his hair. Yeah.
All of that. I mean, there's some really funny stuff in there. And then it gets heavier. But I actually think the tonal shifts are well handled.
Yeah.
But, you know, Clara, for me, the scene that Jenna Coleman sells that I don't know would have worked in any other context is her plea to the Time Lords.
Yeah.
Because I think, for one, there's a massive plot hole there. The Doctor, at any time in those 300 years, could have leaned down to that crack and said, guys, let me tell you the situation.
Yeah,
it's bad.
Yeah.
It's really bad. Look, just trust me.
But that's part of the epic nature of it is, like, that's why, like, that tone of the episode, it doesn't bother me that there is that plot hole, is because it's like,
it almost feels
like it's not meant to be taken literally in a way that it's almost like metaphorical that he wouldn't talk to them in any way.
And I agree. This is like you talking about Smaug at the doorstep.
Exactly. Yeah, I get it.
No, so, but I think Clara's scene there where she, you know, she says, that she gives the explanation about it's not his name, but more than that,
just like here saying that his name is the Doctor, and I was like, fucking thank you! Yes, it is! Like, it's been the whole fucking time! Like, stop it with the Doctor Who shit! He's the Doctor! It's been 50 fucking years! He's just the Doctor! Get the fuck over it!
Yeah.
I did.
Yeah. But it's a beautiful scene, and she plays it so beautifully. And, you know, there's a lot of... You can compare this a lot, actually, to Christopher Eccleston's last episode, where she gets sent away and she comes back. But we don't have a bad wolf thing here, so it's kind of better than that. But no, I mean, I think Clara's scenes there are so good, and there's still inconsistencies in her character. Like, I don't believe the Clara we had met would invent a fake boyfriend for her family. That makes no sense to me with Clara Oswald. But Jenna Coleman is just so fucking good.
Yeah.
And she's been so good, but I think this is her best performance yet in the part. Mm. And I think... And God, I mean, you look at, you know, the last scene of the episode, the way she holds Matt Smith's hand right before he regenerates.
Yeah.
She does some beautiful work here, and I...
And then especially, like, after he regenerates into Peter Capaldi, and they're sort of, like, staring at each other for a good, like, 10 seconds. Like, the look on her face is so priceless. Like, just the, like, extreme shock of, like, oh, what the fuck? It's great.
No, she does really good work, and obviously, you can't... I still need to watch the episode again to fully decide what I thought about some of the makeup stuff, but you cannot overstate what Matt Smith does here.
Yeah, he's like, even if the makeup itself is not good, like, his performance sells the fact that he's old to the point where I don't care
about I agree. And overall, I mean, just, he is such a good actor.
Yeah.
And he never stopped giving his all to this part.
Yeah.
And he never stopped evolving. This is still another phase of the 11th Doctor. Yeah. You know, he never stopped trying to improve his own work in a weird way.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like every episode, he's even more impressive in his run in some ways. And it comes to this one, too. He just does such great work.
Yeah.
So...
Yeah, especially in, like, when he's in the old man makeup, his last scene where he's confronting the Dalek ships, it just sort of feels like a direct echo back to Pandorica opens with, like, his, like, scene on Stonehenge where he gives the big speech. And now it's the same sort of scenario with, like, all these spaceships up in the sky, and all he can do to them is talk, but he's, like, he's kind of just too old and doesn't care anymore. But he has, like, this great moment where he says something like, you've been trying to kill me for 900 years, and now I'm dying of old age. If you want to do something, do it yourself.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah. And then the Time Lords grant him another regeneration cycle.
Yeah.
What'd you think of that?
I thought that was... Yes, because there is precedent, like, I've seen some people kind of call bullshit on, like, that's not a good explanation to how to get past the regeneration limit, but it's like...
It makes sense.
Yeah, there's precedent for, like the Master has constantly... I mean, honestly, for most of the Master's involvement in Doctor Who, the Master has been trying to get another regeneration cycle. And, like, there's always kind of... Like, the regeneration limit stuff has never been explained about why they even have a regeneration limit and all that stuff. So, like, I have no problem with them getting back to the regeneration limit, especially if we're on the 11th Doctor and not the 13th. I still don't understand how we fucked that up
but we fucked it up in, like, the last 4 years is when we fucked up the way the regeneration limit worked.
But, no, you know, and I think also from that standpoint you mentioned before about how for the end of this Doctor, all 11 together, him being, you know, staying put makes sense. I also think the idea of the Time Lords finally not being dicks to him.
Yeah, them just being like, okay, fine.
You earned it.
Yeah. Maybe a little bit, Doctor. Yeah.
Yeah.
And then also, like, the just, I thought it was, because it's just such a fucking cool scene where he finally realized, like he sort of, like, eats third generation energy, and he's like, oh, shit.
You guys are fucked.
Yeah, this is, like, and just, like, the fact that third generation was so, was as big as it was and just, like, destroys the Dalek ship, I just thought it was fucking, that was fucking cool.
It was cool. And I think I'd like it even more the second time if I didn't have the nervousness that would be. Yeah,
exactly.
Last
scene. Like, it was like, just like, oh God, please, please, please give him a proper send off.
Because it's a good scene.
Yeah, it is a good scene, but it's like you want each incarnation of the Doctor to have his moment, like, where he's, you know, not in old man makeup, and he can, like, each regeneration, like, or at least each Doctor's final moments, I think, should be pretty quiet. Like, yes. They should have, like, a moment in the TARDIS or something where they just get to give a little bit of a speech or something.
Absolutely, and Matt Smith's is phenomenal.
Yeah, yeah.
The 11th Doctor's last scene and the last scene of this episode is just perfect. Mm-hmm. Every element of it is just right. And I think from the moment of Clara coming in and being terrified and seeing him walk up and he's young.
Yeah.
And, you know, he is himself again.
Yeah.
And you know, and there's just quiet where he knows it's coming. And I love, even, and again, it's just, it's so well pitched to his version of the Doctor, where, you know, the 10th Doctor railed against death.
Yeah.
The 11th would not do that.
Yeah.
He never would.
Especially after now he is, like his incarnation is, like, 1,200 years old. Like just the amount of time he spent being the 11th Doctor.
Right.
Like, 1,200 years or something ridiculous at this point.
And so I love that, you know, Clara is upset because she loves this man and she doesn't want to see him go. And we as the audience are upset. We are Clara in that scene.
Yeah.
And he's trying to tell us, look, it's okay. I don't care at all. And trust me, I'm not going to forget it. His speech about how, you know, we all change. I will never forget when the Doctor was me.
Yeah.
And that little smile he gives the camera. Oh, God. It's great. And then a very Fifth Doctor-esque seeing Amy.
Because
it just reminded me of, the Fifth Doctor doesn't, like, they didn't bring the actors back, but he has that vision of all
where
companions.
He sees all his companions, and the Master's just like, ha 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 ha.
Yeah, they didn't do that.
They should have just put Anthony Ainley, like, that Master's face up there, and nobody would have any idea who the fuck he was. He's just laughing. Die, Doctor! Die! Die! Fucking awesome.
Again, if you've never seen Caves of Androzani, watch
it. You have to.
Stop this podcast and watch Caves of Androzani. But no, having Amy come back, and, you know,
especially because it was so evident for me, like, marathoning all the Matt Smith stuff, that it's like Amy was, like, his companion. Like, you know, Rory was there, and Rory is fucking awesome. He's my favorite companion of New Who stuff. But, like, his attachment with Amy, just because, like, he didn't have another season with Clara, is so great that it's like he has to be there in his final moments.
And it's a beautiful scene.
Yeah.
And then he's done, and he pulls off the bow tie.
Yeah.
I'll say this, you know, my little brother Thomas, he started watching Doctor Who 100% because of Matt Smith.
Mm-hmm.
And he loves the show now. But Matt Smith is, you know, it's his Doctor. That's the one he started with. That's when he has the emotional connection to. And when he pulled off the bow tie, Thomas was having a tough time.
Uh-huh.
And I can understand. That scene that's traumatizing.
Yeah, that scene is really, because it's so appropriate that, like, the last thing he does is he pulls off the bow tie. And it has that great sound effect, too, of, like, It's like it almost sounds like a sword being sheathed or something. Just shing.
In the 11th hour, the moment he becomes the Doctor
is when he puts on the bow tie. Yeah,
right. It defined him in so many ways, and it's perfect.
In a very weird way.
Yeah,
but yeah.
And then he and Clara kind of holding hands, and I love that it's a quick snap.
Yeah, I really like that too. I've seen some people online really dislike that, but I think that's great because one, you couldn't do the traditional regeneration thing again with, like, the new traditional regeneration thing of the energy spewing out and him changing, because you already did that.
Yeah.
So, it just being, like, he's, like, just about ready to go, and then it's just, like, smack, and then he's Peter Capaldi now. I thought that was fucking awesome. I love that.
A perfect way to disorient you, too.
Exactly.
Because, and that's the thing, is that you have to find that right balance in a Doctor regeneration scene between your own grief of this character leaving and the excitement of the new guy.
Yeah.
And that was perfect because we're wallowing in it, and then it's, what the hell are we watching?
Yeah, exactly. I think it was really well done. Like, I really like Peter Capaldi's little, like,
minute-long
What do you think of the 12th Doctor so far?
I think he's fucking awesome. Yeah, I mean, we don't
know anything about him.
I will say one thing. It is really weird because, you know, it's because this all comes from just how fucking weird Series 7 was with, like, they split in the middle and then, like, the Doctor got a new companion halfway through that series. He got a new costume, like, his, you know, he's because now he's like, the longer coat and stuff. And so he's only, since the 11th Doctor has only been in that costume for, like, 8 episodes, it doesn't fully feel like his, like, costume. Right. Almost to the point that I wish he had changed into his traditional costume
for the last scene. Moment. Oh, I wish that would have been nice.
Because, like, you have this, like, feeling whenever, like, the Doctor regenerates and he's in the old Doctor's clothes that it just feels wrong. Like you see, even, like, in the moment where it's, like, you know, David Tennant being in, like, the leather jacket is just weird because David Tennant, like, his David Tennant's, like, way too thin and slim to pull off a leather jacket. It just feels wrong. Then similarly, Matt Smith with, like, the, like, tight suit and, like, all buttoned up and stuff for right when he regenerates from David Tennant. That just looks weird. It's like Peter Capaldi looks fucking great in the 11th Doctor's second costume.
He does.
So it's almost like it's like it shouldn't just be his costume. Maybe it kind of should. It's really weird. Like you don't quite get the same sense where I think if he had been in like the tweed, you would have gotten this like just looks fucking weird. Where it's like he could totally pull off that coat. It looks really good.
But that 1 minute is great because I love how Peter Capaldi plays the Doctor as batshit insane.
Yeah.
Yeah. And he looks like, when you see him, he's like so out of it.
Yeah.
And they're also
like, what the fuck? Yeah, that's like my favorite moment of the whole of his like new scene is just the 10 seconds right when he regenerates where Clara and him are just sort of staring at each other bug-eyed and neither of them have no idea what is just happening, like what's going on. They like slowly walk towards each other. It's great.
And I like the kidneys joke.
Yeah.
And
you have to have like, it's now tradition that you have to have some like odd line remarking about some part of your body.
And I liked, and I kind of like as the last episode, how do you know how to fly this thing?
Yeah.
It's always nice when the Doctor just kind of loses it after regeneration.
Yeah, which, tends to happen. Yeah.
Yes. But I also thought it was interesting, they are playing up Peter Capaldi's age and his makeup on that.
Yeah.
In real life, he does not look, they made him look grizzled and haggard. And
they didn't try to, like, make him up to look younger than he is. No. Yeah.
If anything, he looks a little older than his actual age in real life. So that was interesting to me. But we don't know anything about the 12th Doctor yet.
Yeah.
We're both very excited.
And although there is, I don't know if you, because you only watched it once, so I don't know if you, like, listened to it close. Because I actually, like, I rewatched, like, that scene, like, 5 times.
I did too. Oh, yeah.
But, like, there's a new musical theme that is behind that scene.
Oh, really?
Yeah, that I don't know. It's definitely a new theme, and it's like, we obviously don't know if that's going to be the proper 12th Doctor theme, but, like, go back and watch that scene and listen to the music, because it's a great theme. Like, I hope that's his theme, because it has this great, like, sort of, like, mad professor vibe to it. Like, that music tells me, like, or at least I think it's going to tell us more about who the 12th Doctor is than anything else that we've seen from him so far, because it's just, like, a great, like, violent, jaunty sort of theme.
I wanted to mention the music really quick, because the song they play under Matt Smith's actual last scene is from Rings of Akaten.
Well, there's two. It starts off with the long song from Rings of Akaten when in the scene where it almost felt like he was the first time around would have been an awesome fucking regeneration moment. Like, obviously, like, this one works a lot better with it being the last, like, his ultimate regeneration limit. But then, like, his actual, the song playing right before he regenerates shifts into the song that plays at the end of Series 5 when Matt Smith is talking to little Amy before he goes into the crack. Yeah.
And I liked both of those.
Yeah, that was a really
great
callback, like, because I don't think that song has been used since.
No, it's a great theme, though. It was used heavily in Series 5, but it's, I was actually listening to it on the way up here. But yeah, so they use those two pieces. They do not use his 11th Doctor theme much in this episode.
They do right, like in the scene where he's like starts regenerating, basically.
Yeah,
like,
I would have,
like, leading up to him regenerating, and then it starts playing the Gallifrey theme there.
Yeah, I would have used it a little more overtly, just because that theme is so great, the I Am the Doctor theme. But
I thought it was used in like the moment it needed to be used in, because like that theme is very much, it feels like it just like builds up to something, and it's like they use that theme when it's building up to him going up to regenerate.
Yeah. So. Murray Gold, oddly, in Day of the Doctor and Time of the Doctor, has used more recycled pieces than he ever has before. He usually does not recycle pieces.
Well, I think it's partially because both of these are
cumulatory.
Yeah. So it's like he's bringing back. So it's like he's reusing, like he does like a very grand version of the Gallifrey theme when the crack opens up and stuff.
Right. I'm not complaining. It's just, like, usually sometimes he'll reuse themes but newly recorded, but like for Matt Smith's last scene, that's just the track from Rings of Aghaten. Yeah. And that's just, it's not a bad thing. It works perfectly in that moment, but it's just a little interesting thing to note. So
I really like that song, so I like it being used there.
So anything else to say about the time of the Doctor?
I really liked it. Like
I liked it too.
And I was like really shocked. While I was watching it, I was shocked that I liked it. And then I went online and saw that everyone hated it. I was like, well, not everyone hated it is a bit extreme, but like a lot of people had a lot of problems with it. I was like, huh.
Yeah.
You
don't see eye to eye with a lot of Doctor
Who. It's just weird. It was a really bizarre experience for me watching this, because it was like, while I was watching it the first time, I was like, I should despise this thing. Like, why am I enjoying it so much?
Well, that's good. And
I've explained why.
And I'm really excited to watch it again.
Yeah.
Especially after talking about it. I mean, that's, to me, the sign of my favorite Doctor Who episodes of recent, is that when we talk about them and I like it more during the discussion, that always means it's a good episode.
Yeah,
it really does.
And then if we start talking about something like...
The Crimson Horror.
Yeah, the Crimson Horror, or Name of the Doctor, and then I just start getting, like, angry, then it's like, okay, that's not a good one.
Yeah. Crimson Horror, which I thought I could at least enjoy on the So Bad It's Good level, but once we talked about it, I was like, no, doesn't even work.
Yeah, Crimson Horror I can now confirm, having rewatched all of them, Crimson Horror is the worst Matt Smith episode.
Okay. I want to say, I got the 7th series box set for Christmas. I want to confirm...
Rory! Yeah! This is the one with the Rory box set.
Yeah. I wanted to confirm that it exists on the podcast, because we joked before that Series 7 was so weird this box set could not actually exist. It does, Sean.
Yeah.
It's got 15 episodes for some weird reason.
Yeah. And then, like, the weirdest part is now, because now we have the 50th anniversary special, and then this episode that's like...
Where it feels
to me like Series 7 is like 17 or 18 episodes or something like ridiculous, because I don't know where else to put those.
You start with a disc with Rory,
yeah.
You go to a disc with Amy, then you have Clara, then you have the Doctor. It's weird.
Yeah.
I forget that Series Amy and Rory were in this season.
Although I will say that marathoning all the Matt Smith stuff, Series 7 works a lot better, because it just feels like the Amy and Rory bit just kind of feels attached to Series 6 in your mind, and then the Clara bit feels like a new series that kind of is cut short.
Right.
So it's still not great having that split, but it definitely works better.
Nice.
than
Well,
I mean, obviously it works better than watching it airing, because it's like watching it airing was one of the most bizarre experiences in my life watching television.
Well, now that I have this box set, I have all of Matt Smith's run on Blu-ray. Well, Time of the Doctor is yet to come out, but I've got that pre-ordered. I'm going to watch the whole thing again before the next season. And I should say, a little news bit that we haven't covered yet, Stephen Moffat has confirmed 100% Series 8 is not being split.
Yeah.
He said that. That's very good.
Yeah, thank God.
That would be unfair to Peter Capaldi if they split.
Yeah, that would be so frustrating. Is this already like frustrating enough that we have to wait till August to see any more stuff with Peter Capaldi?
Yeah.
Fucking goddamn it.
Oh, well.
But at least it'll be a full straight season. Solid run, so yeah.
Okay. So we finished talking about Time of the Doctor. Let's talk about Matt Smith.
Okay.
Sean, what did you think of Matt Smith's Doctor?
I think he's, the kid did good. That's like, he's fucking, especially him coming in, like, off of the back of David Tennant, who was so beloved, and then, like, them giving all the David Tennant fans the biggest kick in the nuts possible with his last line being, I don't want to go. That, like, nobody really wanted to give Matt Smith much of a chance when he came in. And then some people still have never given him a chance and sort of stopped watching the show with David Tennant.
It makes me like more that last line in Time of the Doctor where he says, I will never forget when the Doctor was me.
Yeah.
It almost feels pitched at the fans who would not accept this guy.
Yeah.
But yeah. So go on.
Yeah, but he came in under that pressure and, over the course of the 11th hour, the 11th hour, like, especially rewatching it
so
now
great.
With so much more perspective on it from all the other stuff he's done, it's such a perfect introduction to that Doctor because, like, it all culminates to that moment at the very end where he finally is the Doctor now, and then doing it that way, it's like, if you're willing to accept a new Doctor, which you should be if you're fucking watching Doctor Who, because, he is the 11th/12th Doctor, so... For fuck's sake, like, get over it. They allow you to come to terms with him being the Doctor. Then, like, when he steps through that hologram showing all the other ones and he's fully dressed now, it's so fucking perfect. Like, he just is the Doctor in that moment. And then from there on, like, he's like, Matt Smith himself has been impeccable the entire time, as far as I'm concerned. Like, there have been a couple of bad episodes here and there, and, like, some of Moffat's tendencies to do certain things. I like his catchphrase stuff, like the fucking timey-wimey shit, his use of Doctor Who as a plotline. Like, that shit has always driven me insane, but Matt Smith has always been really strong, and, like, when you give him material like The Doctor's Wife, he has nailed it out of the fucking park.
Yeah. I don't know what to say about Matt Smith. He was not my first Doctor or anything. Yeah. You know, I came in with Christopher Eccleston. I came in with David Tennant. And, you know, even though I love David Tennant, I never had that feeling of, oh, I don't want him to go. You know, he had three seasons. They were good.
Like that weird specials year, too.
Right, and I'm ready to move on. And you should feel that with most Doctors.
Yeah.
And, you know, so I was ready to move on, but I was unprepared for how much I was going to love Matt Smith. Mm-hmm. And I so much feel like he is my Doctor in terms of the relationship I've had with this show so far. In part because he's been the one it's been airing over these last few years. But even more than that, it's just, I really, at least for Modern Who, you know, he's my favorite because there's just something so unique to how he plays the character. And it feels like it's so much honors the Doctors that have come before.
Yeah.
But he also adds so much to it. And I've said this before and I'll say it again. The thing about his performance that kills me from 11th hour all the way to the time of the Doctor, is that he seems ageless and he seems inhuman.
Yeah.
And I don't know how a human performer can do that as well as he does. You never think that he is 26 when you're watching it. Ever. That never comes to mind that he is young. In fact, thinking of him as having an age doesn't come to mind because of the way he plays it.
Even though, for some reason, Modern Who seems damn insistent on
giving him an age, right?
Constantly attaching a fucking number to the Doctor's age.
Right.
Drives me mad.
But he seems ageless, and he seems, when I say inhuman, I mean he really does look and feel alien. And, you know, Matt Smith, he isn't conventionally handsome, so that maybe helps him. Not that he's bad looking or anything.
Yeah.
But he has, you know, he has the chin and stuff. But that's not, he doesn't look alien by any means. But he holds himself in a certain way, and he projects the way he speaks and the way he moves. There's just so much nuance to his performance. And I think, honestly, you know, the last couple of years we've seen so many great male lead performances on TV. You've had, you know, Bryan Cranston on Breaking Bad and Jon Hamm on Mad Men and all these great performances out there. And to me, every year, Matt Smith has been on top of all of those. Because I think what he does in this character is just exemplary.
Yeah.
And those two elements I just said, but so much more than that. You know, he can play that age and he can play that alien quality. But on top of that, he's just such a compelling actor, and he delivers dialogue so well, and he feels so convincing in whatever setting you put him in. He elevates every episode, no matter how bad a script he's given. And not that there were a ton of bad scripts during his run.
But there was the Crimson Horror.
Yeah. But even then, you know, he can even elevate stuff like that. Because Mark Gatiss, for instance, never could figure out how to write the 11th Doctor's voice. Mm-hmm. I don't know what it was, because most of the other writers of this era were very good at writing this specific Doctor's voice. You look at Chris Chibnall and Neil Cross and some of the other, you know, Neil Gaiman and some of the other people who've had this Doctor to write for. They've done it very, very well. Mark Gatiss could not. In a Mark Gatiss episode, Matt Smith still made that dialogue work as 11th Doctor dialogue. Stuff like that. And just, it's just such a great performance. It's so warm, but also it can be intimidating. He just had so many sides to the Doctor, and he was so charming and fun at the same time.
Yeah.
You know, and I really, really, really love his Doctor. And I think this was an interesting era in addition.
Yeah.
But
it is really interesting now, you know, that, like, it's, like, settled. Like it is now, it is the Matt Smith era of Doctor Who. Like, it's done, and you can, like, sort of put it in a box and then look at it and, like, sort of analyze it as a whole. And I think one of, like, the things that you just didn't, like, mention in Matt Smith's performance that obviously is also fucking great is his comedic aspect. Like, his comedic timing and the way he delivers dialogue and the physicality in his comedy is always great. Like one of my favorite Matt Smith episodes is easily The Lodger, where he like, has to spend a month or whatever on Earth in the flat with Craig. That's just that episode. Because that, where, like, the way that episode works so well, and it really works with the 11th Doctor, is because the 11th Doctor is so alien, that's, like, you only fully realize how bizarre and alien he is when you put him in, like, a very mundane setting with a very mundane human character, and he's just completely fucking nuts, you know?
And I love the sequel to that one, too, Closing Time.
Yeah,
they're both great. yeah, I really do. And I think just there's such a wide range, because you think of like the great comedy moments in his life as the Doctor. Many of them, for me, I remember coming from A Christmas Carol.
Yeah, yeah, Christmas Carol is fucking hilarious.
Which I watched on Christmas Eve and just had a blast with.
So fucking funny.
But then my favorite Matt Smith moment ever, and this to me defines his range, where you can go from that great comedy he does, but my favorite moment ever he had is in The Big Bang at Amy's bedside when she's asleep, and he gives the speech, and he feels, you know, older than old.
Yeah.
But he's giving this... It's also, I think, the best thing Stephen Moffat has ever written. That speech is just beautiful. But the way he pitches it and the way Matt Smith delivers that... It's just, it's that to me says everything you need to know about his Doctor, that he can be that and he can be everything else.
Yeah.
It's amazing. It's just an amazing performance. And, you know, again, that a 26-year-old actor could come in and do something this otherworldly is insane to me.
Yeah. It's, he's really, really fucking good. So
we talked about, you know, when we did our Big Doctor Who 50th podcast, we went through and kind of talked about each of the Doctors and their characteristics and stuff. What defines the 11th Doctor for you?
I mean, a lot of it is that age, which is also really appropriate because, you know, as of today, he is the oldest version of the Doctor. Like, he's supposed to be old. Like, he's supposed to be old even compared to the other ones, and he holds that really well. I think part of, like, his physicality is one of, like, the biggest, like, most defining things to me of, like, particularly his performance and the, like, the way the 11th Doctor sort of, like, jumps around everywhere and, like, you know, like, the War Doctor makes fun of, like, how he always has to talk with, like, all these expressions, which I love. He brings into full force in his last speech where it's, like, every single line is accompanied with an elaborate hand movement or something. But, yeah, like, he has this great sort of physicality and energy to him that sort of, in a lot of ways, I think almost kind of masks an aspect of the character's age, but, like, very deliberately so. Like, it feels like he is trying to mask his age to the people around him and, like, not let on the fact that he's lived for thousands of years or whatever.
Yeah, I feel like, especially, you know, coming out of Tennant, who, you know, Tennant, 10th Doctor and his sort of last half of his run was so much about his loneliness and self-imposed isolation. And the 11th Doctor feels very reactionary to that.
Yeah.
Where he is... He desperately does not want to be lonely.
Yeah, he is like almost overly attached to his companions, like Amy and Rory.
Yeah, he just wants to be. He doesn't just want to be with people. I think he wants to be there for people.
Yeah,
and he wants to matter and feel like he matters to other people. And I think one of the most interesting things they did in this run is that, as noble and in so many ways seemingly flawless as the 11th Doctor is, he was put under the microscope a lot.
Yeah.
Especially in Series 6, you know, they kind of put under that a lot of things that make him great, maybe they're also flaws for him, and maybe he's too in love with himself, and maybe he's too self-aggrandizing, and things like that. And I think that's all really interesting, and I think it's well handled. You know, one of the really good episodes from Series 6 is A Good Man Goes to War.
Yeah.
And I think, particularly his performance in that one was, I remember at the time, very revelatory, because we were seeing a different side of the 11th Doctor.
Mm-hmm.
And that this all this sort of myth-making that had been happening so far, they kind of pitch it in a different way in that episode, where maybe he's too in love with his own legend in some ways. And it's not that he does that consciously or that he's consciously selfish or anything, but those are all really interesting character beats to explore, I think.
Yeah.
So, what, I mean, you just watched the entire 11th Doctor's era.
Mm-hmm.
What episode do you think best defines this Doctor?
What episode best defines this Doctor?
Because, like, I think saying favorite is a little...
Yeah, like, my favorite's the Doctor's wife from this run. Like, there's no real question for me. Honestly, the Lodger, probably. I would say that's, like, the one, like, where his performance is so... Because of how, like, powerfully it's juxtaposed with everything around him, it sort of really brings to light who that Doctor is, you know?
Yeah.
Like, that and, like, coupled with, honestly, the time of the Doctor because of, like... Because with the time of the Doctor, him having aged so much, like, sort of, I think, shows some aspects of his personality that you wouldn't get otherwise.
Yeah. And I mean, this is a different case where I feel like, you know, to me, the episode, if you want to define, like, the 10th Doctor, that's his last episode, no questions asked, because that episode contextualized a lot of the inconsistencies in his character. They didn't need to do that with Matt Smith.
Yeah.
You know, Matt Smith didn't need a great regeneration episode to qualify his era.
Yeah.
He happened to get a very good one, and it helps, but it's, you know, it's a different case. Yeah, I think the Lodger's a good, interesting choice that I wouldn't have thought of myself. No. But it's very true what you said. I think the one that I always jump to is just... And it's obvious, but to me, I think Pandorica opens in the Big Bang because they're culminating his, you know, best season.
Yeah.
And they're culminating this introductory arc for the 11th Doctor, and I think he plays just about every shade of that character over those two episodes. And maybe that's cheating in a certain way, because those are special episodes. They're a finale.
And you also said one episode, so then you just proceeded to pick two.
I know.
You fucking
Well, let
asshole.
Me think. I'm gonna try to think of another one.
I mean, out of those two, I would pick the Big Bang to be...
Right.
Because he obviously just goes through more shit in the Big Bang, so...
Yeah.
Honestly, the Big Bang, I think, is a very defining episode for all of the Matt Smith era, because it, like... I think it is the best execution of what is usually a very flawed idea, which is bringing in time travel too much into Doctor... Like, it's a weird thing maybe to say, especially for people who are, like, New Who fans particularly, to say there's too much time travel in Doctor
Right.
Who. But Doctor Who is fucking not a show about time travel.
No.
In the scope of the show, it never has been. And it's one of my biggest complaints with Moffat's run in particular, is that Moffat's maybe a bit too obsessed with the idea of time travel, and he brings it in way too much.
But when he does it well, it's...
Yes.
It's...
But, I mean, the biggest problem with time travel is that time travel is not possible, and it doesn't make any fucking sense whenever you try to implement time travel. And especially Doctor Who has never had rules. Doctor Who, over 50 years, has never established any sort of hard, fast rules for how the time travel in Doctor Who is supposed to work. There's Artron energy, and there is the time vortex, and that is what you get with fucking, as far as time travel goes, in Doctor Who.
Right.
And then now we have, like, fixed points in time is, like, their biggest thing in New Who, which is, like, how many times have they broken the way fixed points in time work? Like, the first one was the Father's Day episode from Christopher Eccleston's run, where if you break a fixed point in time, chronovore monsters come out and start eating reality. Guess what? That never fucking happened again, because in Series 6, they break a fixed moment in time with the Doctor's death, where River Song just decides not to kill him, which also... How does that make any fucking sense? It's like you just decide not to kill him, and you're just like basic... You who is the person who is the only agent that creates the fixed point in time decides not to do the fixed point in time. That makes no fucking sense. But then that does, you know, breaks all of time and makes all of time converge onto one point. And then it's like, you know, and then in Waters of Mars, they basically say you can never break a fixed point in time, really. It's...
Okay, it doesn't make sense. Yes.
Yes, yeah, so time travel never fucking makes sense. And right. The Big Bang, none of that episode makes any fucking sense. If you look at it literally, it is all complete, utter fucking nonsense. Like, nothing... Like, literally, the first thing that happens is the Doctor gives Rory a screwdriver so the Doctor can escape.
Right.
Nope. That's fucking... That is...
It's all these ontological paradoxes, basically.
Exactly. It doesn't... It's utter fucking nonsense. But, like, the Big Bang has so much sort of aplomb about it that it kind of pulls it off that the rest of the stuff doesn't. I don't know why I had a point there, but...
Okay. Well, I think what you were saying is that Series 5 is Moffat doing something incredibly well, near flawlessly.
That he was never able to pull off again.
Yeah, and I think... And honestly, that's the interesting... Overall, I want to say, I think this era of Matt Smith from 11... It's great.
Yeah.
So much good stuff. But... The interesting thing about it is that it starts with Series 5, which is as good a season as you could ever ask for.
Yeah.
That is one of my favorite TV seasons ever. Mm-hmm. Let alone, you know, the best season of Modern Who.
Yeah.
Or one of the best runs Doctor Who has had. You know, it's great. And yet, Moffat would kind of keep chasing some of the ideas he did there to diminishing effect.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I feel like... It's weird because Series 6 felt like it was going to be something different until the point at which we got to Wedding of River Song and realized they were trying to one-up themselves and didn't do it.
Yeah, yeah. It's kind of, we're trying to do the same thing with the way that finale is like sort of like breaks reality and stuff. And it's like, you just stuffed it all into one episode. And
yeah, it doesn't work.
Didn't make any sense.
And Series 7 is a little different in that Series 7 doesn't have an overarching plot completely.
Yeah.
But it's kind of wrapping up other things.
Yeah, but then the Impossible Girl storyline with Laura is very much also kind of that same ilk, you know?
Yeah.
And also, I think, is dumb and doesn't make any... Especially because it's trying to recontextualize the entirety of Doctor Who, which is not something you should ever try to do.
No, it's just not necessary, more than anything else. But yeah, so there's problems. But yeah, this... You just said it yourself. And you know, you've had complaints, but you just said this was a great...
It is fucking, especially rewatching it all marathon, because, you know, I tend, like, Doctor Who is the only TV show I watch as it airs now. Like, I don't, I hate watching TV like this. Like, I just can't not do it with Doctor Who. One, because we have the podcast, and two, I just can't stop myself from doing it. But
like but TV always works better marathon to me, like especially like modern TV. It's just like you should marathon it. Like that feels like the proper way to fucking watch a TV show. To
and hey, it's something Doctor Who's been doing forever because of serialization.
Yeah. So yeah, with like series 6, like rewatching it, I liked series 6 as a whole the first time it aired because it has a lot of really good episodes. But it's like rewatching that as like a marathon, like right after series 5, and then also like I said with series 7, and without the split being as much of a big deal, I think like marathoning it makes that era a lot better to me than I would have felt if I like went on this podcast and not marathoned it right beforehand, because like
I
don't like consuming those episodes piecemeal, and like having them all together gives like they all lend context to each other and like allows me to more like fully breathe the era as it were.
So what do you think this era did well? Was it just that it had a very high batting average? Most of these episodes are good.
I mean, yeah, a lot of it was just like, especially series 6, I think in particular, like the overall series 6 arc didn't like really do a whole lot for me. Like the series 5 arc I think was handled very well, but series 6 just had a lot of just really really good standalone episodes, like The Girl Who Waited, or like The God of Complex, The Doctor's Wife. Like those are all really really fucking good episodes. Or Closing Time is another one from that series.
I would even put in the Rebel Flesh two-parter. I think that's stuff.
Yeah, but like I was thinking of like standalone episodes, that's not true. Two-part episodes, Jonathan.
That one, for some reason in my mind, I think of as being one thing. I know it's two parts, but it's very...
The thing I really like about Rebel Flesh and The Almost People is that it just feels so much like a classic episode of Doctor Who, because the entire thing takes place in like one setting with like five sets. And
it's
like
probably a little too long.
Yeah, this small, focused cast of characters. Yeah, and its only really big flaw is... Okay, like that has like that one really terrible child actor in it. But other than that... Its only real flaw is that it's too long.
That terrible child actor, though, is good for some laughs. Man.
Yeah, because he has, like, two lines, but it's fucking terrible.
He's not even looking at the camera. He's, like, playing with his shirt.
Yeah, he's so, like, visibly extremely nervous. It's like, dude, you're just talking to your dad. Like, this is not...
Yeah.
Yeah.
But also, could go on with what you're saying.
Yeah, but, like, yeah, it has certainly had that really high batting average. But I think unique to the Matt Smith era... is that the Matt Smith era in all of Doctor Who is the only one to have an overarching story across his entire thing, you know?
Yeah.
Like, it's kind of loose, because it's only overarching because of, like, three sentences that are in his last episode. But it's still there. Like, it is still... You do get this sense that, like, the arcs for his season were handled better than any of the other ones have ever been. Like Russell T. Davis's method of handling arcs was...
stupid.
Yeah, like, see Bad Wolf. God, just like you can't just throw a phrase into every single episode
and, Russell T.
and then have that build up into something significant, you know?
No, you can't. And that's the thing is, Russell T. Davies could do emotional arcs spectacularly.
Yeah.
You know, the Ninth Doctor's sort of character arc is great.
Yeah, yeah, but
the plot arc,
is
dumb.
Just like, what the fuck?
He had that whole thing he talked about arc words. We're gonna use arc words. What does that even mean?
You can't, it's exactly that, like, you just can't throw in a word or a phrase, you know, like, because, like, I was looking at, like, I just, like, randomly watched an episode from season 2 relatively recently, and was like, I forgot that Torchwood was
the arc word
from season 2, so it's like, that's just weird, it's so fucking dumb. But yeah, like, luckily, the Matt Smith era has some dumb stuff, but that is not one of them.
No, and I think... it's almost like, you know, what if the Seventh Doctor's era had gotten to conclude?
Yeah, it would have been a lot like that. Yeah, because this does sort of have, like, a Moffat master plan as opposed to the Cartmel master plan.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I think saying Time of the Doctor only creates that arc because of a couple sentences is selling it a little bit short, because that whole thing about Trenzalore and stuff, which seemed so silly to me in a lot of watching it, like when they kept referencing Trenzalore, the actual weight of what that meant to the 11th Doctor does ripple back in time.
Yeah, and it's something... Okay, this is kind of like going back to just talking about Time of the Doctor, but it is something that, like, they haven't fully fleshed this out, but I really fucking hope this is what the explanation is that, you know, because they had in the Name of the Doctor, they go to Trenzalore, and that's where the Doctor's grave is meant to be. I hope that grave is just, like, that scar tissue he leaves behind is just a scar tissue he sheds because he has a new regeneration cycle, like, and that the Trenzalore stuff is done.
That's a question, though, I had. Yeah. Did Name of the Doctor happen now? Because he doesn't die on Trenzalore. He fucking lived.
Yeah, but that's like... Or maybe if they changed a fixed point in time and then the Chronovores are going to eat the universe and that's really...
That's what the 12th Doctor is going to have to face.
Yeah, no. Like, I get, like, they... Because that explanation would make total fucking sense to me. It doesn't explain why there's a TARDIS there, but fucking... Someone could have built that TARDIS, like, looking exterior. They have no idea that that was actually the fucking TARDIS or not.
Yeah. I mean, I'm guessing that we're done with all that story stuff. I think...
Like, there should be a, like... They should address it just to, like, confirm the fact that that is what that scar tissue was... So that the name of the Doctor can happen, because I don't like that episode, but I don't think it should be retconned out of existence, because I hate that shit. Fucking changing what happened after the Time War.
Yeah. No, but I mean, Matt Smith's run, I think the other thing I would say about it, in addition to that uniqueness you said of having this arc, the production values are something you cannot undersell.
Yeah, it's extraordinary. Like, extraordinary. Especially, like, yeah, rewatching it, and they get better and better and better and better and better as the... His era goes on, where it's like some of the episodes and the way they're shot and directed and the visuals, like specifically, I don't like the name of the Doctor, but I love the fucking way it looks. Like,
oh,
it's
yeah.
really well shot, and it's just a spectacular production design.
And the Murray Gold music just got better and better and better too. It's phenomenal over this entire era. The special effects are great. The production design is great. Art direction, all of it, really good. Better than Doctor Who has ever had at any point in its run. You know, the first couple seasons of Modern Who very much fell in line with original Doctor Who in terms of...
how sort of like kitschy and campy the special
effects. Totally low rent, shot on standard definition video.
Yeah.
The first season looks like a soap opera.
Yes, it does.
You know, all of that stuff. And you don't complain about it because that's just Doctor Who has these kind
of
things.
Fucking whatever. I've seen a lot of Doctor Who that looks like a soap opera.
But for some reason, Stephen Moffat was able to evolve the show on a production level in this era. And I think, it's not just a shallow thing. It mattered. They really were able to tell stories differently because of that.
Yeah.
And there's
just got a great sense of style. Like another one, just thinking back to like the way the episodes would look, like Christmas Carol has a great visual design to it.
Mm-hmm. I mean, you look at the Blu-rays I love having just because it's great to see them in that quality.
Yeah.
And
then also the TARDIS console room has gotten better and better. Whereas like this is my favorite, the current TARDIS console room might be my favorite version of the TARDIS console room ever.
It's really cool.
Yeah, it's really, really good looking. It marries sort of like, it kind of looks like how you would want the old TARDIS console room looking today.
Yeah, absolutely.
It has the same sort of basic design aesthetic that just looks fucking cool now.
And I agree. It's my favorite of the modern, at least. But I don't want to sell short Matt Smith's first TARDIS console design. Yeah.
The orange was a lot better than the David Tennant and Christopher Eccleston one, which I still don't like the way that one looks.
No, I don't like it either, but the orangish one is really fun. It's a really great... I love how complex and kind of dense it is. It fits his personality, that it's kind of...
Yeah.
You know, it's big and overdone, and he gets to make lots of hand gestures because of it. So, yeah, I mean, all of that is great. It's just lots of great directors worked on the show, lots of great direction in the show in these last couple years.
Neil Gaiman wrote 2 episodes. That cannot be understated.
I mean, yeah, and there were some good guest writers. I think Stephen Moffat kind of elevated some of the side writers in terms of Modern Who, where I think oftentimes you felt like you had a lot of throwaway scripts in the Russell T. Davies era.
Yeah.
I feel like that very rarely happened here.
You still had, a Crimson Horror or a Curse of the Black Spot.
Yeah. Curse of the Black Spot isn't bad. It's just why is it there? Cold War, why is it there?
A town called Mercy.
Which has great production values.
It has great production values, but that was
when
I was rewatching his seasons, it was Curse of the Black Spot. Is better than I remembered it being, but it's still fucking boring.
It's boring.
Yeah, it's not bad. It's just dull as all hell.
Which is why it's hilarious that Amy's last speech is about the pirates.
Yeah, that's right. That's true. Yeah, and Angels Take Manhattan, that is totally part of her. It's like, and we were with pirates. It's like...
That's what she leads with,
exactly.
John.
It's like, remember that? Those exciting times. And then Town Called Mercy. That is also unbelievably dull.
Yeah.
Like, by the time you get to the end, it's just like...
End.
Yeah.
Please.
It's just like, oh, man. Yeah, but nothing tops Crimson Horror as far as
Crimson Horror is not dull. It is anything but dull.
Yeah, it's not dull, but it is bad.
It is
fucking terrible. That episode is atrocious. It is.
And that's the only one of the Matt Smith era I would say that about.
Yeah, it's the only really bad one. But it is the second. I would have to re-marathon everything again, but in my mind, it is the second worst Modern Who episode.
Yeah.
Behind you know what.
Yep. Love and Monsters. But yes, I think Crimson Horror is the worst. The 4 boring, dull ones to me are Curse of the Black Spot, Night Terrors, which I know you liked.
That one's not great, but I think it's a
Okay, episode. It's not obscenely dull to me, okay. Like the other ones.
I find that one dull. And then Town Called Mercy and Cold War for me. Those are the four.
Yeah, Cold War is another one that, like, on a subsequent viewing, improved for me. Like, dude, it went from being fucking terrible, like, boring, to just being, like, to how I felt about Night Terrors originally. Of, like, this is just okay. Like, it's not an obscenely bad episode of Doctor Who. It's just like, okay, I'll watch this.
Right, okay. So yeah, and those are really the only standout bad ones for me. There's big disappointments like Wedding of River Song.
Yeah.
And I guess my opinion is that it's not a bad episode. It's a bad finale. I forgot about that one.
That's a bad episode in my
opinion.
And actually, I don't know if I would call Name of the Doctor a bad episode, but I really want to call it a bad episode because that is a lot of stupid
To me, the acting in Name of the Doctor discounts it from
being
there. Yeah,
the acting is so good, but it's like the plot is so, like, the Whispermen are so unbelievably underdeveloped. I actually want to run through. This is going to get, like, negative. I don't want to get negative, but fuck it. Like, the Stephen Moffat tropes of, like, that it's, like, part of what has defined Matt Smith's era, some of the dumb shit he has done. Like, one of my least favorite tropes of his is, like, this, we are going to introduce a monster but never, like, fully or properly develop it. And, like, the worst example of that, of all of them, is the Whispermen.
Yeah.
In Name of the Doctor, where it's like, you have this really cool monster design, but it's like, you've done nothing with them. They feel so throwaway and nothing. It's all the other, it's not a Moffat episode, but the only other one that does that as that egregiously is Rings of Akaten with, like, the weird dudes with, like, the gas masks that are in, like, two scenes. It's like, it's a great monster design. I don't really know who or what they are, why they're here, why I should be afraid of them. They're not built or developed at all, and they have nothing to do with the episode as a whole. That's the thing. The Whispermen, like, it could just be Richard Grant. Like, it doesn't need to be anything else. The Great Intelligence could just be there. You don't need the Whispermen. They serve no purpose.
Right.
Yeah.
No, stuff like that, I agree. That's one of those tropes that, and it's one of those things that it's such a minor part of the episode that's in. Like, I love Rings of Akaten. That is one of my top ten Smith episodes. But yeah, it's got that weird little thing with those monsters.
Yeah, like that's the only real flaw in it, is like the middle part just feels disjointed. Like, because it feels like he had a really strong beginning to the episode and a really strong end and didn't know how to connect them fully.
Yeah. So, okay, so we've kind of talked about the era. Do you want to just name some favorite episodes?
Okay. I mean, there's The Doctor's Wife, obviously.
Yeah, it's probably the number one for...
Then I said, you know, The Lodger, 11th Hour, Vincent and the Doctor.
Oh, I love Vincent and the Doctor. That's so great.
That's a really fucking good episode. I mean, honestly, most of the stuff from Series 5 is all really good.
Yeah, those are all great.
Yeah, the finales. Good Man Goes to War, and even though the title is terrible, I still like Let's Kill Hitler.
Let's Kill Hitler is this episode. Great, like, big... Yeah. It's like an Indiana Jones Doctor Who kind of thing. Yeah. I don't even know how to describe it, but there's this big celebratory quality to it because we were coming back from that hiatus, and Let's Kill Hitler was just awesome.
Yeah, Impossible Astronaut is also really good. Even though it is significantly worsened by the explanation that Wedding of Riversong gives, but if you can kind of put that in the back of your mind and ignore the fact that it's just the Tesselecta and that's fucking stupid.
It's a great episode.
Yeah, it's still a really good episode on its own.
Lots of good stuff there. You know, I will always throw my hat in the ring for Bells of St. John. I don't quite know what it is that makes me love that episode. Yeah, but
that episode's not great. Like, it's,
I really love that episode. Yeah. And I thought initially it was just because we had gone through such a weird phase of Doctor Who,
and it finally was refreshing to get something just kind of like, okay, we're starting properly with something. Okay,
but I watched it again recently, and I still love it. And I think the main thing for me is there's this joyous quality to it that he has with getting this new companion, and really that was significant because he had not traveled with someone else yet, and you know we'd had that kind of stop-start quality with the Clara storyline. But I think when it all settles into place in Bells of St. John, and there's this new dynamic with Matt Smith that he gets to play because he has Clara, and Jenna Coleman is so good in that episode, and I think it's a fun... It's not a great story, but it's exactly what it needs to be for the emotional arc of that episode. So I that one, just in terms of infectious Doctor Who joy I get out of watching it, that's one I love. Rings of Akaten, though, the one right after that, is another... Great one for me.
Rings of Akaten's really good.
And Neil Gaiman's other episode, Nightmare in Silver.
That's also a really good episode.
A++, top notch.
Awesome. Warwick Davis is fucking awesome in that one.
I hope they bring him back.
Yeah, I hope so too.
Or give him a spinoff. Just kidding. Sure. We don't.
We don't.
Doctor Who spinoffs don't work well.
It's not gone that well so far.
No, but you know, yeah. So those are some episodes I think. I mean, we mentioned some of the great ones from Series 6, like the God Complex and the Girl Who Waited.
Yeah, those are both really, really good.
Yeah. And Closing Time, I mean, The Lodger kind of overshadows it, but yeah, I think the Lodger's
better, but...
I love both of them. I think they're great. And I agree, The Lodger, because it was fresher, and it's, you know... Yeah. It doesn't have kind of that dumb Cyberman
side. There's no episode like The Lodger in all of Doctor Who. Like, it is so, like, specifically unique to me in a way that's really sort of delicious.
Yeah.
But I was, like, thinking, this isn't necessarily, like... I remembered two things. There are two episodes, two things from two episodes from when I was rewatching it. Power of Three. That episode was so painful to rewatch because that episode is good.
It is good.
For like 90% of its running time. And then you get to the end and everything just goes to shit where they go onto that spaceship and talk to whatever the fuck that alien dude is. And he just sort of explains his plan and is the absolute, like, ultimate example of the Doctor just waving his screwdriver and solving the problem where he's just like, yeah, I'm just doing something.
Technobabble.
Yeah, and the day is saved. And then Amy delivers, like, the worst line in all of the English language.
Do you want to say it?
I can't remember, because I need to remember, like, it has to be exactly what it is.
Give me a second.
Okay, I'll give you a second.
All right, so Sean, I've pulled the quote up. Do you want to do a dramatic reading for us?
Okay, so yes, this, I'm going to do the whole thing, but the line is at the end. So this is at the end of the episode. Amy is giving a speech in summation, and again, note that the episode is called The Power of Three. So that was the year of the slow invasion, when the Earth got cubed and the Doctor came to stay. It was also when we realized something the Shakri never understood. What cubed actually means. The Power of Three.
And you have to remember, while that line is being spoken, she, the Doctor, and Rory all turn to the camera and smile.
And smile into the camera. Yes. It is... It is so fucking bad of any title drop. It is extraordinary. And, you know, this is a season full of fucking title drops because this is from Series 7, so it's got all the Doctor Who shit, which is just... You know, a smorgasbord of terrible fucking title drops. So it is phenomenal that that one is the worst title drop in all of Doctor Who. It's so bad. And again, it's heartbreaking rewatching that episode knowing it's coming, because that's also the episode where Kate Lethbridge-Stewart is first introduced, and she's great, and that episode's really funny, and it's a really good idea for an episode.
It's got Rory's dad.
Yeah, it's got, Brian Williams in it, and it's like fucking... just ruins everything. It so utterly falls apart at the end. And then the other episode that does that also is Journey to the Center of the TARDIS. It's like watching that episode is like... And that episode's not as good as Power 3.
What Journey to the Center of the TARDIS does for me is it alternates. It goes from great scene to shit.
That's a better description of it.
And it ends on shit.
Yeah, and another like really good idea for an episode. And then there's the part in that... Where they have, because I don't know if you remember, they have the three brothers, and one
How
of them dies.
How could I forget?
And then you've got the asshole brother, and the other guy who's an android who doesn't realize he's the youngest brother in the family. And it's like, these two brothers have spent their entire life, like, tricking this poor kid who was in an accident and lost his memory and had to get, like, his, like, voice box replaced into him thinking he's an android. Like, it's... the most disgusting thing. It's so
is that
terrible.
Is that the worst thing anyone's done on 50 years of Doctor Who?
Maybe. Like, it is so inhuman. It's unbelievable.
And you know what's worse is that it's all reversed at the end of the episode, so he's stuck like that.
Yeah, exactly. Because that episode ends with the literal reset button. It's just so fucking
hit
terrible.
The button.
Yeah.
Oh my god. So, overall though, Matt Smith era was great.
Yeah, it was great. You know, there's a lot of really good episodes. There's some bad episodes. Some of those bad episodes are really funny in retrospect or while you're watching it.
Yeah, and you know, it ended on a high note overall.
Thank God that like both the 50th special was really good and then this one I thought was really good, Time of the Doctor. Just, like, it would have been just really sad if this had been like a Name of the Doctor level episode or something, you know?
Right. No, and it was great and the era was great.
Yeah.
And the final episode was really good. And I love Day of the Doctor, which was his penultimate one, and you know, this was a fun year for Doctor Who, I think.
Yeah.
It started off a little weird because we had the Series 7 split thing.
Yeah.
But overall, for the 50th year, we got a bunch of really good episodes, some special stuff, and, you know, we end it with... I think it feels appropriate that we end the 50th year with the 800th episode, with the Doctor getting a new regeneration cycle, and on a new Doctor who seems really exciting.
Yeah. Now we just... Now, like, what would be fucking amazing, though, is if they decided to change the TARDIS console room and the opening credits again for Peter Capaldi and make it, like, completely unique for him.
I hope they don't.
like the most short-lived opening credit sequence in all of Doctor Who history that's around for half a season.
Yep.
Yeah, like, I can't imagine they would do that. Like, no. Hopefully they bother to, you know, replace Matt Smith's face in the opening credits with Peter Capaldi's and not pull a House where they have the same opening credit sequence for the whole show, even when the whole main cast basically changed.
That was, yeah. I forgot House did that.
Yeah. Every time I would, like, occasionally see an episode of House, it's like, none of these people are in this show anymore! What are you doing?
That was weird, even weirder, because they were actually crediting actors who weren't on the show.
Yeah.
I don't even know how that was legal. It was so weird. No. But yeah, Doctor Who, hopefully we'll see Capaldi's face in there, and I hope he looks just as crazy as he did.
He winks. I hope he does this little Sylvester McCoy wink in the cloud.
Exactly. Yeah.
And, you know, that's like one of the great things about the Matt Smith era is right in at the very end, they brought back the credits face, which has been you know, a story tradition ever since the Second Doctor. We have had the Doctor's face vaguely, creepily looming over you in the opening credits at some point.
And I really like how they worked it in. I mean, I like the new opening credit sequence is just great.
Yeah, it's awesome.
I mean, stylistically, Doctor Who in the modern era has just gotten better and better and better.
And in one thing that I really, really like about, like, this weird most recent section of Doctor Who, about, like, the opening credit sequence, is I really like the, like, credits going into the TARDIS and the door opening into the episode.
I like that.
It was something weird that, like, I forgot that started with this version of the opening credits, so when I went back to watch the old stuff, I was like, oh, I forgot that it didn't do that. It's something really weird that I started looking forward to. It's like a cool way to open the episode.
It's cheesy, but it's perfect. It's like the Doctor winking. It just works.
Yeah, exactly.
All right. So, my voice is dying here.
Yeah. Mine is getting a little rough, too.
Okay. So, this was our podcast.
Yeah, this is the way to end it.
This is it for 2013. Our first full year of WGTC. The first full year of WGTC Radio. How do you think it went?
It was complete and utter shit. Like, it's been a total shit show so far. I think we've been terrible at this. We probably should stop, or at least someone should probably stop us.
Oh, they won't. They won't. All right, so I've had fun this year.
Yeah.
Fun podcasting. We'll be back at you next week with our Best of 2013 podcast to get 2014 started. So we'll be talking about all the games and movies and TV shows we loved this year and just kind of looking back on 2013.
Yeah.
So, but anyway, this is our last podcast for the year. So, Happy New Year. Happy Doctor Who. All of that.
Happy Doctor Who year. Yeah. I think I'm going to go get a bow tie.